Welcome to the tonight's meeting of the Standing Committee on Finance. Madam Clerk, item number one.
Order the laying out and acceptance of Coe Road from Upton Street to east of Alfonzi Road, including the taking of an easement for highway purposes over lands of identified property owners. This matter will require a public hearing and notice to abutters. A copy of abutter information is attached. Invited Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent of Engineering.
Time having arrived, I declare the hearing open. Mr. Riley, if you could give an explanation for the public of what this...
Good evening, Commissioners, Councilors. We have no objections to these streets being from private to city. They are constructed subdivisions, and there's no abutter, and there's no taking of anybody's abutter's property. And these streets were created and approved under subdivision control of the new plans.
Thank you. Are there any neighbors or anyone that'd like to come forward and speak on the matter? Come to the rostrum and give your name and address, please.
Good evening. Edgar Ahern, 117 Coe Road, resident for the past 38 years. I'm here to speak for the road to get resurfaced. We understand that it's a private road. No one knew it was a private road. Now that it's a private road, it has to be turned over to you people, the city. You take it over, and then we can get it resurfaced. This road is a disaster, a disaster. This morning, I walked it, and I counted 52 potholes that were patched this past week, not counting all the others that have been done. The road has got frost heaves, waves. You have the school bus that goes down there, the bat bus, trucks delivering to the school. You have your children walking to and from the school, no sidewalks, dodging the potholes. Cars that can't drive on the right side of the road because they're dodging the potholes. I personally had car damage. I had a neighbor that twisted his ankle walking. 2 years ago, in front of my house, I had a 20-foot sinkhole. I put orange cones out there. The city didn't. I put cones. I made a couple of phone calls. Nothing. I took pictures. I went down to the highway department, presented them. Nothing. I'm told, well, you got to see this one. You got to see this one. Finally, I did make a phone call to the right woman. She made a few phone calls. That pothole got fixed. Sinkhole, not pothole, 20-foot in length in front of my house. I only ask you people to think about the safety of the residents, the children walking, the school buses. You can't drive down there doing more than 5 miles an hour. You're shaking, rattling, rolling. Try it. I only ask you to think about the safety of everybody using that road. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else here that wants to speak in favor? Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. Is there anyone here that wants to speak in opposition? If so, please step forward and give your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. Question is on recommending to the full city council to accept the street. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full city council. Item number two.
Order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Norwich Road from Baldwin Road northerly to Coe Road, and for that purpose it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay it out as a public way. Invited Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner, and Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent Engineer.
I didn't see him.
Time having arrived, I declare the hearing open. Good evening, Mr. Riley.
Good evening. This is the same as Coe Road, so no sense in...
Thank you very much. Is there anyone else here in favor of, if so, please step forward and give your name to the clerk.
Really?
Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. Is there anyone here in opposition? If so, please step forward, give your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. Question is on recommending favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full city council. Item number three.
order that the common necessity and convenience of the inhabitants of the city of Brockton require the laying out and acceptance of Gerilyn Drive from Plain Street to west of Genoa Road in a distance of 1,368.87 feet, and for that purpose, it is necessary to take an easement for highway purposes and lay it out as a public way. Invited Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent of Engineering.
Time having arrived, I declare the hearing open. Anybody here in favor, please step forward, give your name to the clerk. Good evening, Mr. Rowley.
Good evening. No objections to this also.
Is there anyone here, anyone else here in favor? Please step forward, give your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. I now declare, is there anyone here in opposition? Please step forward and give your name to the clerk. Seeing none, I declare that portion of the hearing closed. Question is on recommending favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number four.
Order that a portion of Hammond Street laid out by the Board of Mayor and Aldermen on October 17, 1888, and accepted by the Common Council on October 17, 1888, extending from East Street easterly to a point 155 and 200 feet west of Thatcher Street, be in the same is hereby discontinued or abandoned. Invited Lawrence Rowley, DPW Commissioner, Howard B. Newton, DPW Superintendent of Engineering.
This is not a public hearing. Mr. Rowley, if you could explain what's going on here.
We don't have any problems with abandoning this part of Hammond Street.
And if you could just to explain to the councilors about the abandonment, as opposed to
this
what
is,
we just did.
This is what we call a paper street. It's on our plans. It's not a street now. It was never constructed as a street. So that's why we're just going to abandon. It's just like I said, it's a paper street.
Thank you. Councilors, any questions? Councilor Studensky.
The neighbors on the Thatcher Street side and some on the East Street side are in favor of us abandoning that, so there is no street direct cut through across from Thatcher Street over to East Street.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other questions? In that case, the question is on recommending favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you. Thank you, Mr.
Chairman.
Councilor Ranieri.
Mr. Chairman, if I might, I just want to take a moment of personal privilege, and I'd like to do so now than later because I know we have a long agenda, but just something that I want to bring to the attention of people here this evening and to the residents of Ward 3 in regards to a business in my area, if that's okay. And I would just like to make mention, because I've received several phone calls in the last few days in regards to the Blue Dog Shelter, which is closing on Pearl Street. The way the article is written in the newspaper, it has it that JM Pet Resort and Pet Vet is also closing. The owners of this business are somewhat upset, and I don't blame them. But just so everybody understands, the Blue Dog Shelter was something that was adopted by JM Pet Resort and Pet Vet. And because of their situation, it being a nonprofit, they are no longer going to be a part of that business. But the people that are there as JM Pet Resort and Pet Vet will remain, and they just want to make sure that everybody knows, because their phone lines have been flooded the last few days. As I mentioned, the article in the paper was misleading, and naturally I don't want to see any type of business depart from anywhere in the city, and nor do I want to see it happen in Ward 3. They just recently moved there not too many years ago, and as you know, we as a city council just gave them, sold them a partial of land, which was the Cohasset Cemetery, so they could do some renovation work there. So I just want it clear, JM Pet Resort, Pet Vet is not closing. They are stable and will be remaining there on Pearl Street until whenever time the good Lord calls them, I guess, but I just want to make sure it's clear. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Item number five.
Appointment, Tramita Martin to the Brockton Cultural Council. Invited Tramita Martin.
Is Ms. Martin here? If she could step forward to the rostrum and give her name.
Is she here?
Doesn't appear that she's here. I entertain a motion.
Favorable recommendation.
Yeah.
Back to the full city council.
Second.
Any questions, Councilor?
Yes, on the motion. Does she need to be here to
Doesn't
present,
have to
or?
Be, no.
No. Okay.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Okay. All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item number six.
Appointment, LaShika Hamilton to the Brockton Cultural Council. Invited LaShika Hamilton.
Is Ms. Hamilton here? Please step forward to the rostrum. Good evening.
Hello.
Do you have anything you'd like to say?
No, I would just like to say thank you for the opportunity to be a part.
Thank you.
Move to approve.
Mr. Chairman, on the
Councilor Azak.
Motion, I would just like to personally congratulate LaShika. She's an outstanding resident in the city of Brockton, and I'm really happy to see her serve. She's going to do really well on this. So congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Motion made.
Second.
Properly seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Mm-hmm. All those opposed? Recommended favorably, and thank you for your service. Item number 7.
Appointment, Nubi Rato to the Brockton Cultural Council. Invited, Nubi Rato. Hmm.
Yay. Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Do you have anything you'd like to say?
Just good evening.
Move for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you for your service, Mr. Rato, and good luck. Mm-hmm. Item number 8.
Appointment, Jeffrey Thompson as an alternate to the Brockton License Commission for a 3-year term. Invited, Jeffrey Thompson.
Good evening, Mr. Thompson. Anything
good
you'd
evening.
Like to say?
Yes. Good evening, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the Finance Committee. I'd like to take this opportunity to introduce myself and to give you provide a brief background on who I am. For the record, my name is Jeffrey Thompson. I live on the east side of Brockton with my wife and our 3 girls. I'm employed as an attorney here in Brockton. I own and operate my own law practice on North Montello Street. I was born and raised in Brockton. I attended Sacred Heart Elementary School, Colonel Spellman High School, and I graduated Brockton High in 1995. A few years after graduation, I enlisted in the United States Navy, where I honorably served for 7 years. I was stationed in San Diego, California. I served on 2 ships and 1 air squadron. During my time in the Navy, I was able to chip away at my undergraduate degree. So after the completion of my service, I was able to transfer to San Diego State University, where I graduated with my bachelor's degree in political science. Shortly after graduation, I returned to Brockton, and I enrolled in law school. I attended New England Law, where I worked full-time days, and I went to school part-time at night. After I graduated and I passed the bar, I had a great opportunity to open my own practice in John Reardon's building here in Brockton. I'm seeking this appointment because I believe my background, I have a unique skill set that would be an asset to the licensing commission. My military background, I've had experience working with different groups of diverse backgrounds, of diverse opinion. My legal background, I have experience reading statutes, understanding statutes, and applying the law to the facts before me. Therefore, I respectfully request this committee's recommendation to the City Council for my appointment as an alternate to the Brockton Licensing Commission. And I would be happy to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Any questions, councilors? Mm-hmm. Councilor Sullivan.
Attorney Thompson, good evening.
Good evening.
I like the law school you went to because I went to the same one. But I just had a quick question. In your private practice, have you ever had to represent a client before a license commission, either in Brockton or outside the confines?
I have not, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor.
For favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you for your service and good luck.
Thank you, sir.
Item number 9.
Appointment, Marilyn Peters Chu to the position of city auditor for the city of Brockton to fill the unexpired term of Heidi Chuckren. Invited, Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter.
Good evening, Councilor. Just so you know, Ms. Chu is currently the acting auditor under a 60-day appointment from the mayor and has been appointed, recommended for the full-time job. Good evening. Anything you'd like to say?
No.
I think we've all dealt with you as public. You've been in the finance office for about 3 years now?
Over five.
Over five. Five flies, we have a fire.
Yeah, exactly.
Councilor Rodriguez.
Good evening, Miss. How are you?
Good, how are you?
How long is the unexpired term, do you know?
Actually, her expired term already occurred. She was a holdover, so this would be for 3 years.
Okay. All right, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Thank you.
Actually, if I may, I actually spoke to the mayor about this. That was the case a little bit earlier today, but apparently her term is not expired until December of this year.
Oh, wow.
So the way that this is written is actually correct. So I have it under good authority that in November you will be back here again.
Oh, okay. I'll see you then.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you, Councilor. Councilor Farwell.
Mr. Chairman, good evening. I want to bring out your extreme qualifications because I think the public should be reassured that we're having someone come into the auditor's office who is very well educated, very experienced in municipal finance, and I might add with the nuances of Brockton. Just for the record, I understand you graduated from Wellesley College with an undergraduate degree, and it's an MBA from Curry College.
That's correct.
And the last thing I would like to say is that we act on a lot of appointments here, but I can't think of one more important than the auditor. So even though you're the city auditor, you're actually the people's auditor, and you're going to be the final arbiter of what is being paid, how it's being paid, the fact that it comports with law. So I would just ask you to use all of your experience and your fine education to make sure that we do the job that I think the people expect in an auditor. It's a critically important position for the city of Brockton, and I welcome you, and we look forward to working with you.
Thank you so much.
Any other questions?
Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Good luck.
Thank you.
Item number 10.
Order that the new park at the old Roscoe kitchen site be named Charles H. Tartaglia Park. Invited Mr. Charles Tartaglia.
What about 10?
I think that's 11.
10.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Reappointment. William Sharnick as a constable in the city of Brockton.
Not yet, Charlie. Not yet, Charlie.
Term of 3 years. Invited William Sharnick.
Calm down, young man.
Good evening.
Good evening. Your name?
William Sharnick.
Any questions?
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Mr. Sharnick, good evening.
Good evening.
This is a reappointment. How long you've been a constable within the city?
Oh, you had to ask that question.
Guesstimate.
Probably a tad over 40 years.
40 years.
By my privilege.
Okay. You're duly qualified. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you
and good luck. Now we're on item number 11.
Mm-hmm. Order that the new park at the old Roscoe kitchen site be named Charles H. Tartaglia Park. Invited Mr. Charles Tartaglia.
And your name, sir, for the record?
Charles H. Tartaglia.
Council Moynihan.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you know, or if you don't know, the city took over Roscoe's kitchen site on Warren Ave near the corner of Bartlett Street. A couple of years back, we worked on a parks grant, which it's also one of the grants that we were able to renovate James Edgar Park with. We were lucky to win this award to make a park out of that that land that we have we've gotten from the city. It's near completion right now. We were thinking more too. So I was thinking of a name for that park, for somebody that really would you know deserve that. Somebody in the ward that's done a lot for the ward, for the city. Myself, actually, Councilor Farwell, who's more eloquent than me, can speak on this also. But he filed it with me, and we talked to the mayor also, planning department, and we couldn't think of anybody more deserving than Charles Tartaglia, owner of George's Cafe, who has been involved as a Ward 2 city councilor. He's on the board of Massasoit. He has donated money, his food, to all different events we've had down at James Edgar Park. I don't know how many sports teams that for youth that he has sponsored, especially George's Cafe in the West Little League, who has won numerous championships. I think Mr. Malley's here today. I think we won a lot over his, too. Is that correct, Mr. Malley? But I really couldn't think of anybody else that was more deserving than Mr. Tattaglia. And I'm going to pass it off to Councilor Farwell, who I'm sure would like to. Are you thirsty and hungry?
I'm always, yes. Seriously, Charlie, I can't think of anyone else who deserves this more than you do. And I understand you mentioned that used to be your paper route when you were much younger down in that area.
West Park Street was my first paper route.
First paper route.
Yeah, and that started it, I guess, in that area.
And a lot of people don't realize that you have hired a number of people who have come in from other countries. They've worked for you. They've actually rented property that you own, and you have welcomed them, and you've trained them. And I really think you're the epitome of what we hope the business community would be like here in Brockton, giving people opportunities and giving back to the community. Massasoit Community College, you served on the Board of Trustees, State Boxing Commission, Deputy Commissioner. I mean, we could be here all night, but it's a real pleasure to be part of this.
Thank you, Counselor. And it's good to be here, Chairman, Counselors. I appreciate the opportunity for the naming of the park. And I will always respect the park that I, with my name on it, even if I have to mow the lawn.
Now, could you donate the pizzas if we have a party down there?
We've got that coming up, Counselor, down Edgar Park, I think, the end of this month?
Yes, yes.
Okay, no problem.
Anybody else? Before we take a vote, anybody else?
Move for a favorable recommendation on Mr. Tattaglia.
Second.
With this, also referring it to the Parks and Recreation Commission for their approval.
Oh, yes.
On that.
And, Councilor, just so you know, we will be sending notification to the Park Department, which I believe, have you served on that before, or your brothers?
I was on the Park Commission. I was on the BCCT. I was on the Massasoit. I don't know how many boards I've been on. But I did serve on the Park Department.
I think when we do the plaque, we won't list all the things that you've done because we can't afford to have the plaque that big. So unless Councilor Monahan wants to donate.
Tommy will take it out of his kitty.
Yeah, if Councilor Monahan donates, it'll be in cardboard. So
at least I donate it.
On behalf of myself and my family, I'd like to congratulate you two. I think it's a great honor, and I know what your family has done for the city and yourself. And with that, recommended favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? We'll see you at the dedication.
Thank you. Thank you very much, councilors. Thank you.
Item number 12.
Order appropriation of $4,990.26 from the fiscal year 2015-16 Hazardous Materials Emergency Preparedness Grant to the City of Brockton Emergency Management Agency Fiscal Year 15-16 Hazardous Materials Emergency Preparedness Grant Fund. These funds will be used to conduct planning and planning equipment for BEMA, no match required. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Stephen Hook, Jr., Director.
Good evening, Councilors.
Good evening, Mr. Conan. Long time no see.
A long time no see, and we're asking that you actually table this appropriation request. And the reason for it is there was some leftover money in the state. They asked us to apply for the funding. This is slightly less than $5,000. We did so. The documents were a little late getting in. We filed them to get them accomplished, and then we didn't have a meeting last month. And so at this point, we wouldn't have the authority to spend them in time if you appropriated it. So we ask
table. Do we need to table this?
Just a table, yes.
Motion made, second. All those in favor? All those opposed? Item number 12 is tabled. Thank you, Mr. Condon. Item number 13.
Order appropriation of $4,764.40 from the Brockton Emergency Management Fiscal 15 State Homeland Security Program to the BEMA Fiscal 15 State Homeland Security Program Grant Fund. This funding will be used to purchase mobile communications equipment for BEMA. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Stephen Hook, Jr., Director.
Good evening, Councilors. This is just a straight federal grant, no match required.
Move to recommend favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Item 14.
Order, acceptance and expenditure of a donation in the amount of $14,461.29 from Brewster Ambulance Service Incorporated to the City of Brockton Fire Department. The Fire Department intends to use these funds to purchase 9 Dell tablets. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Johnny Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening, Councilors.
If you can just give us a pretty cut and dried.
Sure. Within the ambulance agreement, when we signed that contract, Brewster Ambulance agreed to purchase 9 tablets for each of their units within the city. That's what this $14,000 is for.
Motion to make a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Okay. Thank you, Chief. Item number 15.
Order, appropriation of $13,500 from the fiscal year 2017 Massachusetts Department of Public Health Naloxone grant to the City of Brockton Police Department, fiscal 2017 Massachusetts Department of Public Health Naloxone grant fund. These funds are to be used by both the police and fire departments to purchase Naloxone, otherwise known as Narcon, and supplies related to the administering of this drug. No match required. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Johnny Condon, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief, Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Move favorable recommendation.
Second.
Second. On the motion, I have a question for...
Councilor Barnes, for...
I guess whomever is here
I
to...
I think it's going to have to be Chief Williams.
Well, okay. Chief Williams, yes, thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. This is the second or third time that one of these kind of little money grants have come through for the Narcan, for the administration of the Narcan little
Correct.
Tubes and stuff. Why does it come piecemeal? Is there not like a year supply? How does that, why is it broken out like that?
Councilor, I don't have an answer for that.
Okay.
Other than it's a grant delivered to the city. It's split up between police and fire. I'm not sure on the amount why it's done piecemeal like that.
Okay, I have that. That was actually my other question too. So how much or how many units of this, of the Narcan, will this particular funding buy us? Seeing as the price went up recently for it too.
And Councilor, I apologize. I'm not exactly sure of the unit cost.
Okay.
So I couldn't give you an answer on that. I could get that for you though.
Okay, that would be great.
Sure.
And you might know this one. So I was going to ask, so who gets it? Because I'm under the impression, or I've been told, that some of the active users in the street are actually getting the Narcan to have on
not,
their person.
Not this Narcan, though.
Okay, so this goes to first responders and things?
Correct. Correct. This is okay. Strictly basically for police and fire.
Yeah. Okay. All right, great. Thank you, Chief.
You're welcome.
I don't know if Lieutenant Littlehand wants to...
Actually, yeah.
Captain, Lieutenant.
Good evening.
Captain.
Good evening, Lieutenant.
Hi.
Approximately 216 units are purchased with that $13,000 at $60 a unit.
216 at 60?
I thought it might be going down to $45 a unit, so we'll actually get more. Who gets it? I know that each patrol badge, every badge in Brockton Police carry 2 units per man.
Okay.
And with the epidemic, usually they use both units. And then they're replaced immediately.
Okay. And then, so the rest of them, I guess, would go in like a fire kit or on the ambulance and things like that? Is it broken up?
As far as the police department, they're held in a filing cabinet and they're issued as they're used, reissued as used.
Oh, okay. Okay, so on a shift, a roll call, you'll get your tubes.
Every patrolman, every badge in the police department, 186, if that's our number, each carry 2.
Okay.
And those replaced as used.
Okay. All right. Now, are you familiar with how civilians are getting the Narcan at all?
You can get it through your pharmacies. You can get it through Learn to Cope. There's different organizations that will train and give that drug.
Okay. But the city is not administering these units to civilians.
We cannot because I have a prescription for the Brockton Police Department.
Okay.
I can give that to no one else but Brockton Police Department.
Got it. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Welcome. Lieutenant. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Any other questions? I believe motion was made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Item 16.
Order appropriation of $125,000 from the fiscal year 17 Safe and Successful Youth Initiative Grant to the City of Brockton Police Department fiscal year 2017 Safe and Successful Youth Initiative Grant Fund. These funds will be used to hire street outreach, case management, behavioral health, tiered employment and education services for targeted group of youth ages 17 to 24 between July 1st, 2016 and June 30th, 2017. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Good evening.
Good evening.
If you can fill us in on this grant.
I have an ace that can fill you in on this. She's got her fingers on the pulse. That would be Michelle Tebow.
Good evening.
The grant is used, as it was explained, to hire street outreach services, case management, behavioral health, tiered employment, and education services, which is hired through the Old Colony YMCA. It's exclusively hired directly through them, and then they hire the education and the employment services through BayWib.
Questions?
Yes, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, yes, thank you. Just for clarification, so this will be administered through the Y?
Or it's administered through my office. We don't get any money. It's a complete in-kind match, my time,
okay,
and that of Sergeant Vidaro. Otherwise, the monies go directly to the provider.
Okay. Okay, great. Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome,
you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Counselor Powell?
Just, good evening. Just to clarify, an outside vendor will hire the different people you need or the different services that you need?
Correct.
Using this grant?
Correct.
And is this continuing or is this a brand new grant?
No, it's continuing. We started actually in 2012. We went to 14, 15. It was removed for a year, and then we came back on board with it. So the services are already part and parcel of a program that's already in place called Safe Corners Street Outreach at the YMCA.
Okay, and I know it's a grant, but you've been very well satisfied with the return on the investment of this and the results. Do we have a process to review how a grant of this size is performing?
Absolutely, absolutely. There's a lot of reporting mechanisms that we have on the state level and locally.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Entertain a motion.
Move in favor, recommendation.
Second. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably back to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Motion is approved. Item 17.
Order appropriation of $90,000 from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Executive Office of Health and Human Services, Department of Mental Health, fiscal year 2017 and fiscal year 2018 police-based jail diversion grant to the City of Brockton Police Department of Health and Human Services, Department of Mental Health, fiscal year 2017 and 18 police-based jail diversion grant fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, John Crowley, Police Chief.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Actually, you know what? For the people at home, can you state your name and rank?
My name is Richard Lenahan, a lieutenant for the Brockton Police Department.
We all know that, just for the people at
Thank
home.
Thank you.
Thank you. And if you could explain this one.
Jail diversion grant is used to divert folks that are suffering from mental illness from the court system into appropriate treatment. It's an outstanding program. We're helping members of society. We're reducing calls to their homes. There's an understanding for mental health with the police department. We have 25 CIT, crisis intervention team members that are trained. One third of the department is trained in mental health first aid. And every member of the police department and across Massachusetts have been trained in mental health awareness. That took place last year with NAMI, Department of Mental Health, the Municipal Police Academy, and myself. We put the program together and it rolled out last year.
Questions? Motion?
Move for favorable recommendation.
Second. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you. Item number 18.
Order transfer of $90,000 fire department capital projects, council order 211 of April 2015 to the fire department capital projects Zentron fire station alerting system. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Michael Williams, Fire Chief.
Good evening, Chief.
Good evening again.
You could give us a little background on this one.
This is basically a reappropriation of funds that were put in this fund for licensing of our emergency 911 system back in 2015. At the time, we were told we were going to have to pay $30,000 per answering point within my fire alarm office. The state then found that too many communities would be obviously financially affected. They came up with the money themselves, so the state has paid for that. So now we have that $90,000 that we'd like to reappropriate and use for a Zetron system, which is our alerting system. It enables us to integrate that with our computer-aided dispatch system. That includes all my fire apparatus and also Brewster Ambulance.
Motion for favorable recommendation.
On the motion, please. Thank you, Chief. Sure. Okay, so this is new technology that's going to be implemented into the department?
It's a new generation. We have a Zetron system now, but it's about 15 years old.
Okay, so it's an upgrade to that.
Exactly.
Okay, so now with the upgrade, will there be any downtime or any lag time in kind of switching over the conversion?
The radio companies have that all in place where they can almost do it seamlessly.
Oh, okay, and about how long will it take to convert totally?
That I'm not sure on.
Okay.
It will be, you know, within like probably a 2 or 3 week project.
Oh, okay. Got it.
To install, because it has to be installed in each station, each of the new Brewster Ambulance stations, all of that has to be equipped.
Okay. And is there a maintenance cost to this new technology?
There is, but it's built into my budget.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. And so it'll be upgraded and everything else?
Correct.
Okay. And how often does it, you said the first system is about 15 years old. How often would you recommend that this alert system be?
That's not really my forte, but I'm hoping to at least get another 15 years out of it.
Okay.
I would hope, if
okay.
not more.
All right, great. Thank you, Chief.
You're
Thank
welcome.
You, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other questions? Entertain a motion.
Motion to recommend favorably to the
second.
Full City Council.
Motion made seconded to recommend favorably to the full City Council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Item number 19.
Order appropriation of the award of $50,000 from the State Department of Housing and Economic Development to the City of Brockton Parking Authority Housing and Economic Development Grant Fund. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Robert Malley, Executive Director of Parking Authority.
You need to set up a, is that for this one or?
Yeah, that's later on.
That's later on,
yeah,
not for this
item. A couple items down.
Okay.
Actually was in the form of an amendment to the state budget put in by Representative Cronin and then supported by our delegation, which earmarks $50,000 for the parking study, which you will be hearing about later, for the downtown parking study.
Motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to the full City Council.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Malley. Item number 20.
Order that the personnel director research the salary levels for comparable positions in the school department and municipal government and prepare a report for review by the City Council. Further, that this report be provided within 90 days of the date of this order unless the personnel director requests additional time. Invited Maureen Cruz, personnel director.
Councilor Fowell, I believe you filed this.
Yes. And very briefly, because I did not have a chance to look at this before coming this evening, but thank you for doing the research on this. Let me tell my colleagues what this is not about. This is not about suggesting that someone is receiving an inappropriate salary on the school side. It's about employee relations, because we are all one city, and we do have comparable job titles. We have comparable job responsibilities. And what I hope we will do is over time mitigate perhaps the disparity between the school side salaries, which seem to be higher, and I'll defer to you in a minute, Ms. Cruz, and the city side salaries. That has an effect on obviously school appropriations. It has an effect on pension costs to the extent that it's not a position covered by the state teacher retirement system. So having said that, why don't I allow you to just give us some highlights from this, and then obviously if some of my colleagues have questions, we could have you come back at a later time when everyone's digested this information.
Absolutely, and I do apologize that I didn't finalize it until today and get it to you all today. I did email it to you as well as give it to you in hard copy, but I will briefly go over it and I'll certainly come back at a later meeting and answer any additional questions that you might have.
And that's not a problem, by the way. No criticism intended.
Nope.
So
It was a little bit more work than I realized. There's a lot of employment contracts at the school department that I had to obtain and go through in order to compile all the stuff.
I will say the font is not, for someone perhaps in my age bracket, this 8-point font is a little bit challenging.
Well, I realized that. I was trying to keep it side-by-side comparison, so enlarging.
You can't use 44-point on.
I can read it. I'm sorry.
So as you will work your way through this, you will see that most city department heads that are listed on here are, their salaries are set by city ordinance and approved by city council. Many department heads at the school department are employment contracts that are set by the superintendent of schools, and salaries are equal. They are calculated at a rate equal to the BEA members multiplied by a ratio as approved by school committee. So those ratios are used in these employment contracts for many executive team members. I also have put on here some different staffing levels within certain departments so that you can also see that the staffing levels are very different between the city and school. So as you will work your way through this, you'll see that currently the chief financial officer, the top salary for the chief financial officer is $153,065, and the city auditor is a max salary is $100,277. Both of those titles oversee the school department in everything as far as the financials are concerned. And the chief budget director, and again, as Councilor Farwell said, this is not to say that anyone at the school department is earning a salary that they're not entitled to or that they are not doing the job. This is just the facts as they are out there. The chief budget director at the school department is a salary of $154,816. So the city auditor and the chief financial officer are both lower than the current chief budget director at the school department. The supervisor of payroll, the finance department has a junior financial analyst and a senior clerk, and those salaries are there. With the auditor's office, you have an assistant city auditor whose salary, the top step is $83,619. She is responsible, that title is responsible in the absence of the city auditor to oversee everything again that the school department handles in their financial departments, including payroll. The school department has the title of accountant as well as the auditor's office. The top step for the accountant in the auditor's office is $71,620, and the salary for the accountant in the school department is $97,288. The supervisor of payroll in the city side has a salary of $54,005. They receive a stipend in the auditor's office that was put in by a city ordinance to offset the difference in the salary of the supervisor of payroll on the city side compared to the supervisor of payroll on the school department side. You'll see that the supervisor of payroll on the school department side has a salary of $75,000. From the perspective of the director of personnel, I don't agree with the stipend. I think that our stipend should be built into the salary of the employee and not be set by ordinance. We also have only two payroll people on the city side, and on the school department, you will see that we have six payroll clerks. Now, granted, the school department has over 3,400 employees, but again, the staffing between the two departments is very different. The city has a supervisor of accounts payable. That salary maxes out at $54,000. The school department has three accounts payable clerks, and their salaries, as you can see, their salary structure is very different than the city employee unions. They have four steps, but they also have a breakdown of different years. The city side employees start at step one in a position and advance their way to the top unless it's a promotion. There is some language that they can go to top step. The school department doesn't handle it that way. They do it differently. So they can be first year, second year, all the way up to 20th year, but they can go anywhere in this range. They can be set at that schedule by the department head at the appropriate school department, department head. The secretary to the city auditor, who also is the secretary to this finance committee, has a salary of top step of $50,852. The school department payroll, the finance department has a 12-month confidential secretary, salary of $60,818. And then there are 12-month administrative assistants in that department. We'll move on to the personnel department. The director of personnel maxes out at $91,470. The school department has an executive director of human resources, salary of $145,854, with three associate director of human resources, salary of $126,980. The personnel department in the city has three clerks who handle insurances and personnel matters. The school department has a 12-month confidential secretary who makes $60,818, and they have five 12-month administrative assistants with those salary ranges. The public property department, superintendent of buildings, who is responsible for all city buildings, including school buildings, not only just the buildings in the school, that the superintendent of building is also responsible for the custodians and all the inspectorial, the wiring inspectors and public property inspectors. That salary maxes out at $105,340. We have a director of facilities maintenance who makes $115,343. Now that person is only responsible for school buildings. Please remember that your superintendent is building, is technically responsible for every one of those buildings in the school department. We have a supervisor of building maintenance, and that position, there are different, depending on the different licenses, there are, you'll see those salaries. There is a supervisor of shift building and grounds, and that salary at the school department is $81,500. We have, in the public property department, we have trades gentlemen who are carpenters, electricians, plumbers, and there is a different salary range for those employees based on the number of licenses that they might hold. And then the school department has building maintenance craftsmen, which technically under civil service law, these employees are not supposed to be licensed employees, but I believe many of them are licensed, and so they do the similar work of the carpenters and electricians, and you will see their salaries based on the years of service. Custodians, the city custodian, a senior custodian makes $53,082. The senior custodians at the school department have a range where the depending on whether they're days or nights. The school department also has a variety of different custodian levels. We have a senior and junior building custodians. The last one that I compared is the information technology department. You will see that in the ordinance salary chart, there is a department head called data processing department head, which a max salary of $86,164. That position has never been filled in the city because the salary is not a marketable salary for an IT position of a department head, and the union employees make a much larger salary than that salary, so we've never been able to even advertise that position. As you will see, we have two assistant data processing managers, top step $112,397. One of those individuals receives a $3,000 annual stipend to serve as the acting department head. Then we have head systems analyst, network system administrators, head computer operator, technical support specialist, and you'll see the salaries there. The school department, their IT department, the employees used to be employment contract. They have just recently settled and will be moving into a union. So these salaries are what their present salaries are, and they will be being added to a salary structure within the union contract that they have just been affiliated with, but that has not happened yet. So I didn't do all departments. These pretty much are the ones that have similar positions to look across the board at. And again, I apologize that it wasn't to you sooner than today, but I certainly will come back at a later date and answer any questions that you don't have tonight.
I think I'd just, again, like to say thank you for doing all of this work and conclude my remarks by saying that I think we should transmit this to the school committee. We have an elected team of people who are responsible for overseeing the schools. I hope what will happen is over time the school committee will take into account the data that you have presented and make any adjustments they can. It would be my one hope, as having come originally from the school committee, that we get to a point in this city with sufficient fiscal stability that we don't lay off teachers every April or May and cause that kind of disruption. And I think the first start is to sometimes take a painful look at what we're currently doing and can we improve in terms of employee relations, in terms of money expended, and in terms of fairness and decency. It just seems to me a senior building custodian over here should be comparably paid commensurate with his or her duties. Likewise, the school senior custodian should be comparably paid. And when you have a wide disparity, I think it is fair to say there has always been some tension between the school side and the municipal side. So again, thank you, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Maureen. How are you?
Good evening, Councilor.
Thank you for the information, too. It's somewhat earth-shattering, but not so much earth-shattering, because I, as like Council Fowle, we both came from the same neighborhood in regards to school department versus city side. But there's a couple of things that there's no doubt bothers me, and I hope that maybe we can start to rectify sooner than later. And you said it, you know, the superintendent of buildings, and you know, the superintendent of buildings is his position or her position, whatever, is much more than what we take it to be, because all the school buildings belong to us because they're tenants. And so he has to oversee that. And when I look and see a director of facilities, you know, in the school department, you know, making, you know, $115,000, and the superintendent of buildings is making $105,000, you know, what went wrong, you know, is what I probably asked that question. But I think that's something that definitely, you know, we definitely have to start to take a look at, because it's just not, it's to me, it's just not fair. It's not apples for apples, really. I mean, I understand you need to have a director of facilities at the school department, because, you know, they should be working with the building superintendent, because there's always a day-to-day situation that you know, takes place there. But he's also on call. I'm sure the director of facilities is on call somewhat, too. But, you know, the building superintendent is on call for no matter what it may be, you know, even if it's just an alarm that goes off, even if it is just a small fire, something where the director of facilities can just say, okay, it's under control, the building superintendent, I can roll over, you know, and finish my nap. But, you know, I'm not trying to be rude about it, but that bothers me more so than any of them. And the other one, and you mentioned as well, you know, the data processing department head, not having a department head, I think that we should be ashamed of ourselves. And I think what we probably need to do, and I'd want to see done sooner than later, is how can we correct that? And you're right. How can you advertise for somebody to come in and make $80,000 when the people that you're going to be telling, you know, what you'd like them to do and to work with you is making $90,000 to $100,000? It's tough. It really is. So I mean, I don't know what we have to do there, but I think we need to do that sooner than later as well. I think those are two things we have to need to start to take a look at. And I agree with, you know, Councilor Fowle. And so there's always been, for whatever reason, that separation of, you know, school department, city, but we're all one. You know, we're all one in one helmet here, and we should all be working together. But, you know, I do want to see us do something. So maybe the next time you come in, that may be something we can talk about, is what do we need to, obviously it needs to be an ordinance change. And I think we should address it sooner than later. Don't you? I mean, what's your thought, you know?
I think it's something that it needs to be looked at seriously. And I think as the years move on and certain department heads elect to retire, I think that you will have some difficulty filling some of these positions at the salaries that are currently in place. Many of these department heads have 3-year terms and a residency requirement. So I think that if you're going to attract good talent, that you're going to have to start looking at some of those department head salaries and putting them where they need to be. in the marketplace.
I agree with you, and well said. So that was just my comment. So, you know, I look forward to the next time you come in. Maybe we can start to really look at that one item as the first one to, because I think it's well overdue. It's well overdue. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. Anyone else? Counselor, do you want to postpone this, or do you want to just recommend a favorably?
Yeah.
The points made, just recommend it favorably.
I think we'll recommend favorably, and then if there are any ordinance changes, they can be advanced by a member here.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to recommend favorably.
Just on the...
On the motion.
Just on the motion, then, Counsel, I know since you, through you, Mr. Chairman, the Counselor filed that, I know you brought this to our attention. I think it's well needed, yeah. But maybe, you know, you and I, as a member of the Ordinance Committee and any other Ordinance Committee, that we could start to take a look at it with you to what we can do to take care of a couple of these things and start to get an ordinance in place, especially the data processing one. I think that should be taken care of. I really do. So well, if that's okay to...
So,
yeah.
So the motion is made and seconded to recommend favorably
we'll
to the full
it
City
that
Council.
Way. Yeah.
And then you can create anything towards the ordinance that you'd like.
Exactly.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably to full City Council. Thank you, Ms. Cruz. Good job. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Razak.
I'd like to take number 23 out of order. Mr. Yazwinski lives outside of the city, and it this resolve has been postponed a couple of times, so I would just,
again,
we shouldn't be too long.
Motion made and seconded to take item 23 out of order. All those in favor? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, item number 23, please.
Resolve, invited guests from Father Bill's in Mainspring to present their next project at 682 North Main Street and discuss the state of homelessness overall in the city of Brockton. Invited John Yazwinski, President and CEO, Nicole Fitzgerald, VP of Asset Management.
Good evening, Mr. Yazwinski.
Thank you.
Councilor Razak, sure. I believe you filed this?
Yes, I did. Thank you for being here tonight, John. I know tonight you're here to kind of present a little bit about your new project that's actually in Ward 7. Tell us a little bit about it. And over the summer, we did meet at your location, Jack's Place, which most of my colleagues have had a chance to visit. We had a community meeting there, and it was, you know, it was well attended. I have to tell you that some of the residents that before the meeting, when we posted the meetings, they were all had kind of negative thoughts, but once they were at the meeting and they left, many of them felt much better, and they were happy that they had gone to the meeting and had many of their questions answered. We have... In the city, we, you know, we're a large city. We have a homeless problem, which you're going to, you know, tell us a little bit about. And we're very compassionate towards it. We just, there's some misconceptions out there. Whether it's residents or business owners, it's kind of a, you know, they see Perkins Park, and they think that that's what's going to be reproduced throughout the city. So when they see beautiful buildings like Jack's Place, and you answer questions like that, you have your employees on site that take care of your tenants, that you're responsible for them. These are things that are reassuring to residents. So once they leave, they feel much better. So I thank you. I thank you for being available to us, answering our questions, and really you guys were very, yourself as well as your colleague Nicole, answered all the questions that we had. And I know one of the questions that I had asked you over the summer was to give us a number. Another question that's out there is how many homeless people that are in Brockton are actually residents from the city of Brockton. And thank you for getting us that information. I truly appreciate it. So tell us a little bit about it, and we won't, you know, keep you that long. Thank you.
No, I appreciate it, and thank you for taking me out of order. First, I'd just like to recognize Officer Richard Lenahan. You know, we work in Brockton for a long time, many communities, and just to say, you know, Officer Lenahan works with our most vulnerable homeless population every day, and he does a tremendous job of communicating with us, working side by side in a compassionate way with our most vulnerable citizens of the city. So I just wanted to thank Officer Linehan for all of his support with that. So there was a couple of quick things I wanted to go over with the council, and thank you, Councilor Asak. Of course, was to talk quickly about what's in your packet, 682 North Main Street, our next development, answer any questions. Second was to just give you a brief state of the homeless in Brockton, data, geography, Perkins Park recommendations, and just wanted to 30-second touch upon some zoning changes that have been kind of presented to the council. So 682, so people that are know, we're happy to say that 695 North Main Street, across the street from 682, which has been a vacant parcel for over 7 years, has been developed, as you all know. It's a home now for 22 formerly homeless families or individuals. We have about 8 veterans that are formerly homeless have moved in already. We opened it up in August. And then we have our most disabled individuals and then 2 families. So thank you for all of that support. Our hope is for 682, and we've met with the Montello Business Association with the support of Councilor Asak and Councilor Lally, and with the neighborhoods, as Councilor Asak has presented, to answer any of their questions and present what you have in front of you here today. Our game plan is to knock all the buildings down in that way, as our structural engineers have said that these buildings need to be to the ground. They're structurally unsafe. Our goal would be is to develop 23 single person apartments with common space for educational services. 12 of those 23 units would be for prioritized for homeless veterans for housing. And we are now in the process of going through approval with the planning board, which we recently had, and we'll be putting our permits in. So this again will be supportive housing. It will, it's permanent housing. We will be approaching the state later this fall, hoping to bring back close to over $3 million of new money to the city to develop this parcel here that's been vacant, like I said, for almost a decade now. So we will have staff on site, as we have across the street. We have over 400 units of this housing model. It's been a success. And it really is the answer to places like Mainspring House, is to provide supportive, affordable housing for our most vulnerable citizens. So with that, we're excited about the opportunity to take some distressed properties, get state and federal funding and private money into the community, and to be able to take some of our vulnerable citizens off the street. And again, and our full goal is to end homelessness, but also is to end veterans homelessness. And we're getting very close to that. When I started at Father Bill's Place in Mainspring in 1996, 20% of our population were veterans. And last year it was 11%. So 11% is still too many, but we are on our way, and can't thank enough the city for their support. So if, as you can see in your packet, you see what the front of the building would look like on North Main Street, and then you would see how the layout would be at the parcel. You could see that we would have plenty of parking. If you think of the apartments in your packet, that's basically pretty close to the same footprint of the Faniff Hospital building. So we're literally knocking down the Faniff Hospital and the additions that have been put on through the years, and developing a new building. And if as you all drive by 695 North Main, just think of that same building being across the street. So, take any questions about that before I move on.
You all set, Councilor?
Yes, thank you.
Councilor Monahan.
Yes, excuse me, John. Just a question. You are one of the few nonprofits that actually give back to the city as far as some donate. I know you do with Mainspring. I think it was 10,000. Are you planning on increasing that at all, these other properties that you have to the city?
So with the properties that we have towards housing, we have participated in the pilot program. Mm-hmm. And so if you think of 26 Spring Street next to Mainspring House, we've been paying about $10,000 a year in payment in lieu. For Jack's Place across the street from this property, we have budgeted about $7,000, and we would do payment in lieu with this property also.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, John, for coming this evening. First of all, we realize that what you do is extremely challenging, and it's not going to get any easier. I was at that meeting way back at the beginning of the summer. We learned a lot, and what I particularly want to emphasize this evening is the support network that you have currently in the building across the street, and we're the old fan of hospital, and used to be actually Catholic Charities several years back, is going to be another facility like that. We appreciate that you consider our veterans, because we appreciate the fact that they've served, and it's heartbreaking to realize that these individuals end up in the situations they do. I also am happy to hear that we will be receiving donations in lieu or in the future. I mean, I'm always looking at a way that other communities, because we have a list here of people out, don't realize it says community of origin for guests of Mainspring. It says here out of state, unknown. That one always concerns me, because I mean, usually people know where they've come from. And we see a lot, say, Brockton. And I realize we're one of the largest cities in the Commonwealth, but it just seems that I'm always concerned that when people say Brockton, it's because they're, you know, currently in Brockton, but maybe they came from somewhere else and they don't want to disclose where they originally came from. And I'm looking at it, and I'm always hoping that we're going to be working on an opportunity here to see the other communities that, how would I say, contribute to the condition with individuals in these challenging situations, but fiscally aren't there to assist us. And you know, you can relate to it because you're a nonprofit. We're a city with some financial challenges too, so I'm looking at some, how would I say, response to all this, and hope that something's coming along.
So thank you. So in your packet, you, as Councillor said, there's a community of origin for guests at Mainspring, and I've given you one sheet that's a little bit of a quick snapshot and then more detail. But you know, in a sense of the 968 unduplicated people that came to Mainspring House, you'll see that 604, 62%, came with ties to Brockton as a last permanent address. And in a sense of the next group was Boston at 35 people at 3%. And you can see from there, it's 3%, 2%, 1%. And you have 52 communities that literally make up 1% or less, or 13% total. And if we get, you know, the one thing I would say is that, you know, there were 117 unduplicated Brockton residents that stayed in Boston last year. There was 41 that stayed in our shelter in Quincy. That there is an issue of homelessness in our region that does not have boundaries a little bit, because there's gateways into these cities in a sense of employment, mental health, substance abuse, you know, other treatment programs, courthouses, and other things. But is to say that we need to attack it at a regional level. So one of the things that we've focused on is, if you look at Plymouth, that is number 4 on the list, you know, it's 21 people at 2%, is we've opened up a shelter in Plymouth. And it's serving over 40 to 50 people a year, and it's in two churches. And we've created 40 units of housing over the last 7 years in Plymouth, because we don't want people to have to come to Brockton or Quincy to get shelter without any state support. We've done it on private contributions. Wareham, 10 people, 1%, but is in the top 10, 15 of people that come to Brockton. We've opened up another shelter there with the faith community. So again, as Councillor has said, we are trying to go to the communities, especially in the southeast, that have people that come to Brockton or Quincy, to the two only shelters, not counting Fall River, New Bedford, and Taunton, that we see upticks, and say, you need to take some responsibility, and we're willing to develop housing in your communities. And we're doing that in Wareham, and we're doing that in Plymouth. We have a project to develop housing right now in Wareham. The other thing I would like to say is, in your packet, I provided a three-day stay policy that we have here in Brockton and at Father Bill's in Quincy. And what that is it tells you that if you're not from these communities that we've listed right here, that you can only stay at Father Bill's in Mainspring or at Mainspring House for 3 days. Because the majority of people that get dropped off at Mainspring House from the police or from different institutions or corrections or get discharged from state systems of care, like 30% of the people that come to us are coming straight from state systems of care, from mental health hospitals, from detoxes, from Department of Youth Services, 18 to 21 year olds, is we'll make sure those people have a safe place to stay for 3 days. But you will see in our packet that if they cannot verify through some kind of documentation that they don't have ties to this community, and it, for some people it might look a little bit liberal, but I think this is substantial in a sense of we don't want to turn people away that have family members here in this community or come here for work and end up being homeless or being discriminated against or come here for a treatment program and get shown the streets. They don't have a safe place to go. Is we give people a chance to catch their breath and then we get them back to their community. So even if you think of over the 900 plus people that come to Mainspring House, that you can see the majority of those people will end up leaving in 3 days and at least are not eligible for the shelter stay at Mainspring House. We are doing our best to be a local provider, to be part of a vibrant community, and to put responsibility back on the state and back on the other communities, and I hope this shows this. The other thing I would like to say is that there have been a lot of comments in the newspapers and in public statements across the year about how many homeless people there are outside. And in your packet, you'll see a census report of the current point in time count. So every community in the country has to do a point in time count for HUD. And we all have to do it on January 27th, the last Wednesday of every month. And you could see at Mainspring House, we had 157 individuals. We had 13 homeless people we counted on the streets for 170 individuals. What we did this year is we said, we know there are more people than that are out on the streets in the warm months. So we did another count this past August on the 16th. You will see that we had 123 individuals staying at Mainspring House, and we had 46 homeless individuals. That number, 46, has been, you know, give or take, you know, 10, 15 people, either way, has been pretty consistent over the last 2 to 3 years. So again, 968 unduplicated people. We know that, you know, we are serving on average about 130 people a night all year round. The Department of Housing and Community Development is only paying us for 51 people, men and women, a night at a bed rate of $26. We have not seen an increase, a substantial increase, in about 17 years, with the opiate and the substance abuse crisis, which is makes up over 50% of the people coming to us. Well, we have a real public health crisis going on, not just in this city and across the Commonwealth, as you all know. And Mainspring House has become the safety net. It's become the scapegoat, and it's the place that people would like to blame for systems that are breaking down. We used to have over 20,000 housing units in institutions. And thank God we don't have those institutions of mental health and treatment programs, because we can do better than state hospitals. But we're down to less than 800. But those were still places that people lived in the late 70s and early 80s. And we have less than 800 of those units now. This is a public policy issue. It's a public health issue. And with the rising rents, people that are making 0 to 30% income are struggling to make it in our community. The other thing I'd like to bring up is Perkins Park. As you know, this has continually become a conversation. And what I would recommend is for the council to look at our proposal for a planning process about this. We would hope that if we could really look at Perkins Park and develop a revitalization plan for Perkins Park that would help our downtown community. We are willing to put the resources to help coordinate that and to pull together the bodies that we've named in here with the Mayor's Task Force on Homelessness, with yourselves and with all the other groups, and if other groups that we haven't mentioned here, to really look at urban parks and how do you address them and how we can address them in our city. So before I get to the last, I'd welcome any questions, of course. Thank you.
Councilor Burns.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. John, I just have a few questions about some of the things you said, and I'm going to go back to several of your presentations. So on the more extensive presentation for the count, community of origin for guests. So you said that, I just want to be clear, so you said that some of them that identify as having ties to Brockton, you're using kind of a chart or something that that Brockton was their last legal address?
Last known address, permanent address.
Okay, but are some of the people, like Councilor Beauregard said, they may not be willing to kind of really admit that they may be from like a Hanson or a, you know, a Bridgewater or something, or just say that they're from Brockton? Are you finding that that is an issue, that maybe people come from other places looking for some of those services that you said that we provide here, and then they end up staying here, which ultimately gives them ties to Brockton?
You know, nobody is running to Brockton to stay on the sleep on the floor at Mainspring House.
Okay.
We do not have enough beds to accommodate everybody. So, you know, the idea that people are running here to stay at Mainspring, I think what we have here is many of the people are coming to us, and they're from these communities that I've listed on the three-day mm-hmm. stay, which is a regional approach. And but they've, if they're not from Brockton, if they are or they're not from Brockton, they've got to verify either through a state ID, a recent utility bill, a lease, eviction notice, a letter from the RMV. They've got to verify that they have ties to our community. You know, if they're working in Brockton, then yeah, we're going to let them stay in Brockton. They're working here. If they're homeless, if they go to school here, if they're going to the community college, you know, 18 to 21 year olds are fastest growing population at Mainspring. If they're going to Massasoit, we're going to allow them to stay here. Brockton High School students are growing at the Mainspring House. You know, so they've got to prove either residence, working, or school, to be able to stay longer than 3 days over at the Mainspring House. Now, does that mean that they're not going to be out on the streets? Absolutely. Maybe they could stay on the streets. But we do have plenty of people that come here for other services and end up coming to Mainspring. But if they're not from that catchment area that's listed in our three-day stay, mm-hmm. then we're saying you've got 3 days, and we're going to work with you very intensively to get you back to the community that you're from. And we provide bus passes, transportation, we'll drive you there, we'll work with your family and your friends. You know, we will work absolutely intensely to make sure that you have a safe place to go. You know, if somebody is fleeing a domestic violence situation, absolutely we're not going to put them to the streets. So we will make those accommodations.
Okay, now you just actually triggered something else. So this growing population of teens, really, you know, Brockton High students. Is DCF involved in that in any way, or how is that happening? And what kind of interventions are you guys, you know, able to do with all the other things that you have?
At Mainspring House, it's 18 and over. So, and kids can sign out at 18, or they get aged out, and the state moves on.
Yeah.
So if you're 18 or 19 year olds, you could still get some services, but most of the young adults that we see, especially from, you know, from the local schools, have been in institutions the majority of their life and are literally resistant to getting the services from the state, and are really looking for nonprofits like us or others, or a lot of the times it's the teachers at the school or the guidance counselors to protect and care for them. So absolutely, there's a breakdown from the state of discharges to places like the Mainspring House.
Are you in communication with the school department to address some of this?
Yeah, we work very closely with the school department on unaccompanied youth.
Okay.
And we've actually created some apartments, and we have our own youth protocol at Mainspring House for Brockton High School seniors that are 18 and over, where we will literally have our own protocol and our own entry system, and we've had our own housing just dedicated to that group. And Massasoit now has so many homeless young adults that they're approaching us and talking about how to support these students also.
Wow.
But again, it goes back to, you know, the recession, you know, from 09 through 12, the cuts at the state system, and 25 or 30% of our population are coming straight from state systems.
I see. I remember you talking about that before, and that when you had the 10-year coalition back then, and you were saying that that was an issue then.
Yes.
And that was about 10 years ago. So it's just, I mean, I can't believe we're still talking about the same kind of thing. Something could have and should have been done in these, you know, 9 or 10 years. But that's my commentary on that. So now the count, the census report of the folks that are unsheltered, where are they? Where are you finding them to be unsheltered?
Well, you know, they're right now, and I'm, you know, all of you may know this, they're spread out throughout the city of Brockton. You know, the majority of them were down at a tent city that had been around longer than Mainspring House, had been around over 30 years.
Right.
But you know, that number has gone down, actually, of the unsheltered. But
is it the clearing of Tent City that maybe, do you see the reduction in that? Was that help or a hurt?
No, I wish more people had come in, but they didn't. I think we did see an uptick of people coming to Mainspring House when the clearing happened. All I'm saying is that Tent City, you know, we always had 40 to 50 core homeless, unsheltered people that we really knew well that lived down there, you know, for, you know, over, you know, almost two decades. The population had changed, but the number kind of stayed consistent. What we have now is, and, you know, the city did that for public safety and absolutely understand that, but now we've got it where Perkins Park and a lot of other spots in downtown, people have scattered, and it's like squeezing a balloon. It's just kind of spread. It's kind of gone to other areas, and so that 46 is a point in time, but it absolutely mirrors the data that we've had consistently of how many active people we are working on the streets over the last 2 years. So, you know, I've seen numbers in the paper like 70, 80, 100 people. We count people, we work with people every day, we have a street outreach person. That's a pretty solid number of, you know, I'm not saying it's not 50 or 60 at some point and a little lower at other points, especially the winter of what we're working with, but that's a solid number.
Okay, and one other thing too, a lot of what you do, you know, has to do with, I guess, a good relationship with the state. So you mentioned about the formula that they use, the per bed number is peanuts, really, for,
yeah,
you know, the services that you need to provide to these folks. So is there any, and I'm just kind of thinking kind of like the school department, what they're doing, you know, reviving that Webby case and all of these things in the Chapter 70 and all that stuff. Is there any kind of movement from the service providers of the homeless population to challenge the state in their formula and how they calculate what your programs like yours and all around the state, what they would need to be able to actually fix this problem?
You know, I've been at Father Bill's in Mainspring for 20 years, and it's been very rare that we'd ever walk up and ask for more shelter dollars, because we believe in helping people get jobs and helping people get into programs and helping people get housing, and we've always advocated for that. Mm-hmm. But over the last 3 to 4 years, because of the crisis that's going on in all of our communities, we've actually asked for an increase in shelter. And we've gotten a small amounts, but nothing that really shows an investment to deal with the crisis and a public health issue, especially the opiate crisis that we have going on, of the amount of people that need shelter. So we have not been successful, but we've been advocating for an increase in resources. Father Bill's in Mainspring is absolutely willing to have another conversation with the city about a new model. And the new model would be is more of a housing resource center that would have a mixed use type of opportunity that you would have, instead of 130, 150 people sleeping at night, you would have maybe 30 to 50 beds, but you would have a real triage and assessment mentality. You would have a day program, and you would be able to get people in during the day. You would rapidly rehouse them, but you would have a very strategic and hefty housing agenda, not for everybody that comes to us, but only for the 20 or 30% of our most disabled, our most chronic, our most expensive homeless individuals that ricochet in and out of systems of care. We would more than willing to do that, not just in the city of Brockton, but put that responsibility on the other communities, as we've already started to do. So We have advocated, and we'd be also looking at a strategy of converting a mainspring house to more of a, like if you think of a medical emergency room, and then they decide where you go from there.
Triage.
Think of a mainspring house, a triage and assessment, and then have the appropriate supportive housing or treatment access. But we would need an infusion more than $25 to keep people in during the day, to triage and assess them, and to move them on. But the savings in soft costs of in and out of emergency rooms, in and out of police stations, in and out of corrections, in and out of treatment, it would be tremendous to the taxpayer.
Right, okay. All right, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Before Council Beauregard asks a second question, anybody else that hasn't spoken? Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hey, thank you, John, for being here tonight.
Thank you.
What prevents you from developing? I see 23 single apartment unit being developed on that site. And when you're talking at about 900 individuals looking for services, in a way, it almost looks like you're putting a little Band-Aid on this big problem that we have in the community. What prevents you from developing a larger unit? I know funding could be an issue sometimes, but for some odd reason, it seems like, you know, you're going after 23 units when in reality we should go after, you know, maybe after 60 to 70 units to really kind of make an impact I understand the laws that apply in the city, but I'm talking about from a standpoint from your agency in terms of looking for significant numbers of housing units to deal with the housing issue in the city.
Thank you, Councilor Rodriguez. I think there's two things. One would be across the greater, outside of Boston, but is the number one reason why we have a lot of homeless shelters across the Commonwealth, it doesn't matter if it's suburban or urban, is the zoning laws. Is the zoning laws are keeping us from developing the amount of affordable housing units, especially the supportive housing units that we need. The second thing would be is we really feel like the most successful for this population is not to have big buildings with 100 people that all are struggling, you know, formerly homeless. That a scattered site approach, 20 units here, 25 units there, 30 units there, is really good, not just for the people we assist, but also for the neighborhood and the community. So a little bit of a scattered site approach, we think, does well as being a good neighbor. So I think it's a combination of the zoning laws are very challenging to put those type of projects specifically to homeless individuals. It's very hard. It's been very hard, you know, intimately to develop housing for our poorest neighbors. And so the challenge is there's a lot of barriers in front of us in communities to get this done. But it makes absolute sense to do it, and it makes sense to do it in a sense of cost-wise, to develop larger units. I think a lot of it would take more political will from our community leaders to develop this type of housing to that type of production.
So are you saying that the zoning laws in the city of Brockton does not allow you to develop anything larger than 23 units?
It would be very hard to do it on zoning, but also just political will.
Well, you know, one of the issues that I often have with our city is that there's a lot of individuals in this community that do not see Brockton as a city, and often somehow we think that we live in Avon South, and that we're not really living in the city of Brockton with city problems. I honestly would rather have a 50-unit apartment building dealing with the homeless issues versus 23 people living in a nice building and another 23 roaming the streets like they're in search of, it's sad to say, but a lot of times when you do spend time driving around this city, looking at some of the things that you do, and with the influx of The Walking Dead and some of these other things that you see on television, that's what it reminds you of. You know, and that cannot be a good sign for businesses coming into our community or even citizens, to be honest with you, because, you know, yeah, we've got these nice buildings that are handling a small number of people, but at the same time, it's not creating a very good sight for people to see. So I think the mentality needs to somehow change. We do have issues with homeless folks. Those issues aren't going to go away. We've been talking about homelessness in the city for since I, before my hair has actually turned gray. And actually, I had a lot more hair back then too. But
me too.
You know, but it's one of the it's one of those issues that I think we're going to continue seeing. But I think the mentality has to change. And it, we had talked about, you know, changing some ordinances, doing some things to benefit some individuals. But I think we need to look into, you know, seriously embracing the issue of dealing with homelessness, not putting these little Band-Aid on problems. Because, I mean, when you house 23. There's another 50 that needs housing. By the time you figure out how to house those 50, there's another 50 or 60 down here waiting to, you know, for housing issues. And the problems keep getting bigger and bigger, and I think we need to kind of change that mentality to begin with.
Yeah, we're and it doesn't necessarily have to be a Father Bills and Mainspring development plan. I think it needs to we need to put some pressure back onto the larger housing developers that when they're developing housing, that maybe you know, a certain percentage is absolutely for our 0 to 30% chronic homeless individuals. That if you're going to build a 50 or 60 or 100 unit apartment, then make sure that there's earmarked units for some of these for the people so that you don't have a 50 unit building with people that are all coming out of Mainspring House. There's a few ways to go about this, and we would welcome a larger conversation about how to do that, because we're developing now because our people are going to become our customer forever at Mainspring House or in our community, but we would absolutely welcome that. And I think that touches upon the last point, which is the proposed changes to the Brockton zoning ordinance that was presented here.
Mr. Chairman, we can't discuss this because it's a pending matter.
The zoning, we can't.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
One last question, Mr. Chairman. What do we get in terms of funding from the federal government? I know what the state is doing. I know what the city does on its own. But what do we get from the federal government in terms of funding towards your organization to deal with the homeless issue in the city?
So there is a HUD grant that comes to the region, not just to the city of Brockton. And that Father Bills in Mainspring, it goes out to a consortia of providers. South Shore Housing, Old Colony Y, and Father Bills in Mainspring are the three lead agencies that get those resources. And that's all gone towards our housing projects that you've seen here. Besides that, it's really the home dollars that come to the city of Brockton that we could apply towards some of these projects. And all we're looking for ever in a project like that is just, you know, just give us a little bit, like, you know, 50, 100,000, and we'll come back with 3 or 4 million leverage from the federal and the state. So, they're sad to say, Brockton's not an entitlement community, and we need to address that with our congressional delegation because those formulas are outdated.
Why is that?
It's old formulas that are outdated, you know, decades and decades ago that we should be addressing. The city of Newton or the town of Newton gets more homeless dollars than the city of Brockton based on old formulas of housing stock. So the formulas are outdated, the resources aren't coming here, and we're bringing the resources to the city through regional grants. We do our best. We've not asked for any money operationally from the city budget. We know, you know, people that we ask a lot from the emergency services, but just think about all the people that are struggling outside if we didn't have a Mainspring House.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Do you have something quick? Because we got to move on.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you again, John. Three things here. First of all, I want to commend you for this Perkins Park revitalization proposed planning process. That's a lot to say at one time here. And I hope you make this open to the public, available, because I believe this is when everyone thinks of the homeless situation, they picture that, you know, scenario, and it looks so rough during the summer months, and that's rather distressing. And for someone like myself that's looking forward to having a great deal of businesses in this city and in the downtown area, want to work with this. Something I want to, it was twofold here. As a professional, you go to conferences and whatever. Other communities are going with these challenges. Are there some new, how would I say, ideas that we can try here that maybe we can look at, maybe we should have another forum on? And also, since this,
Through the chair.
I think maybe we should, we can invite John again another night and have him go over some of these, because I mean, with this information, you've opened up many doors and different things that we can work together on. I think that would be great, Counselor, if, you know, we could have him on here, bring him on again for another resolve to discuss some of this.
If you, we'll let Counselor Beauregard finish up quickly.
Yes. Okay, and the last part is, and I think I brought this up before when we met, and I'm hoping that some people are looking at this that are in the same sort of industry as yourself, I'll use that term, with this opiate epidemic, and we know that a great deal of it was caused by the pharmaceutical industry. Are we getting any money? Is anyone going after the pharmaceutical industry?
Counsel, that's not a homeless question. Certainly affects that, but that's certainly outside the scope of what we can be asking here. Is that your last question?
Yes, yes. Thank you.
That would be too much to ask. Counselor?
Yeah, just a quick follow-up to what I brought up in terms of grant. We haven't had one of these in a while, so.
Yeah.
Is there any way you can provide us with a breakdown of funding as to what we get, what the region gets for funding from the federal, the state, and any other? You don't have to be very specific in terms of the private fundings that you get, but I mean, at least from the federal and the state, what we get for homeless here in the city. Is anywhere you can provide us with that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Councilor Razak.
Well, thank you, John, again, for this information. With that, I motion to send it to favorably to the full city council.
Second.
Motion made, seconded, to recommend to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much, John.
Thank you, and thank you, Councilor Razak and Light, for your support with our a new project. Thank you.
Item number 21.
Order adopting a fuel-efficient vehicle policy as part of the Massachusetts Green Communities Initiative fuel-efficient vehicle policy. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, and or his designee, John A. Conan, Chief Financial Officer, Kathleen A. Smith, J.D., Superintendent of Schools, Michael Morris, Chief Procurement Officer.
Good evening, Mr. Condon.
Good evening, Councilors. I would speak favorably on this matter. The adoption of this order would help the city to qualify as a green community.
Yes.
By qualifying as a green community, we would qualify also for grant funding. Mm-hmm. And the policy that's being requested to be adopted doesn't compel us to buy any cars until we need them. It doesn't cover police cruisers. It doesn't cover heavy DPW vehicles. So there are exemptions so that we can continue to buy cars structured the way we would like them to be. But it does allow us to get the opportunity to get some grant funding as a green community.
Councilor Barnes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Condon. I just have a question. So BAT is a private Leon Transportation Company, were they involved in that? Because they have all of those hybrid buses that they've been trying to replace the fleet with. Did that play into that at all?
With respect to this particular
the qualifications order, of becoming green community.
I think it might help, because but it's not strictly a city agency, because it's a regional transit authority.
Right.
But it would help, because the vast majority of its funding comes from the city of Brockton, so it would help. But this is only applicable to the city vehicles. City and school.
Okay, I understand. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other questions?
Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item 22.
Order that the Public Safety Committee of the City Council shall perform an audit of current licenses issued by the council, review the restrictions, if any, on those licenses, and evaluate related ordinances which affect code enforcement. Invited John Crowley, Police Chief, William Schleiman, Sergeant.
Counselor, this should actually have been referred to the Public Safety Committee.
Yeah.
I'm going to refer this to Public Safety. Item 24.
Resolve that the Brockton Water Systems Manager, a representative of the Brockton Water Commission, a representative of the Central Plymouth County Water District Commission, Mr. Alex Mansfield, and Ms. Pine Dubois of the Jones River Watershed Association be invited to a meeting of the City Council to discuss issues affecting the quality and quantity of the city's water resources. The address of Jones River Watershed Association is 55 Landing Road, Kingston, Mass. 02364. Invited Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner, Brian Creedon, Water Systems Manager, Ozzie Jordan, Water Commission, Paul Collis, Commissioner of Central Plymouth County Water District. Jack O'Leary, Commissioner of Central Plymouth County Water District. Alex Manfield, Ecology Program Director, Jones River Watershed Association. Pine Dubois, Executive Director, Jones River Watershed Association.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Farwell.
Pending information from the Law Department regarding issues they're working on, I move to postpone this to the first FinCom meeting in December.
Second.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to postpone till the first FinCom meeting in December. All those in favor? All those opposed? Postpone till the first meeting in December. Item 25.
Resolved to have Matthew Zaylor of the Trinity Financial Corp. and any other individual from this company to update the City Council as to the development of a parking garage at the Enterprise Block and any information regarding a restaurant inside this establishment. Invited Robert Malley, Executive Director of Parking Authority, Matthew Zaylor, Trinity Financial Corp., and or his designee.
Good evening, Mr. Zaylor. Do I say that right? Zaylor or Zaylor?
Zaylor, please.
Zaylor.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. Thank you for having me this evening.
I believe this was, who filed this? Councilor Beauregard?
Yes.
Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, I filed this way back in the beginning of the spring here. And what we wanted to do was find out a few things because the Enterprise Block is certainly very attractive and it's full to capacity. We wanted to get a little bit more detail on that. And we particularly wanted to find out what was happening with the restaurant and other prospective businesses. And now we realize that you also have a second project that you'd like to show us this evening also.
Sure, I thought it might be helpful to give you an overview of where we are today, talk about the current project, and then speak to the questions that have been raised. So I have a couple of boards. Should I display here?
You can display them there, and if any councilors need to get up and look, or we can carry the photographs around.
Everybody
see that? Yep. We don't see that far anyways very well, so you can describe, and then if we need to, so anybody can step up.
Okay, so the phase one project is now complete. Thank you all for your support and help with that project. It consists of 113 residential units and 89 parking spaces below grade, as well as the rehab of the Enterprise newspaper building, 55,000 square feet of office space, and about 5,000 square feet dedicated to a future retail use, hopefully a restaurant is our plan. It also consists of 184 space parking lot, which is also the home of phase two, the next project. You can see on this diagram that I have before you here, I've outlined phase one in blue. Phase two is in red, and that project consists of approximately 111 units of housing and 85 spaces below grade, as well as a structured parking garage of 474 spaces. Those spaces will be utilized by the residential building. Approximately 55 spaces will go to the residential building. The two buildings, phase one and phase two, to meet the parking needs for that building, a one-to-one parking ratio. And then we'll reserve 100 spaces for the use of the Enterprise building for the tenants of that building and pay the city rates for those spaces. And then 319 spaces will be for the parking authority and for the city. So grand total of net revenue to the city is 419 spaces, 319 spaces of new revenue. So that's phase two. And then you could see the parcels in green, which outline what is the downtown action strategy that you've all been working on here in the city, the creation of approximately 600 additional units of housing and ground floor retail within the city. And so we're proposing some changes to that plan, a new street that was further up Petronelli Way. We've shifted it down to be on city land, as well as the potential to make Petronelli Way a two-way street to help with traffic flow. So that is the phase two project. So I can address any specific questions. I can talk a little bit about the two questions that Councilor Beauregard raised. So, you know, we've presented this to the city and our 40R permit approves phase two. So we have approvals to build phase two. We are going back before the planning board to get some changes to the permit, some minor modifications to accommodate program changes. So for example, The original parking garage was 371 spaces. Now we're at 474 based on the needs of the city and what we understand to be the uses that would eventually like to accommodate in the downtown. As it relates to the restaurant, you know, we are actively talking to potential restaurant tenants. We are having ongoing conversations, but we have yet to find a tenant for the space. So we're working on it actively.
Council Beauregard, you all said?
Yes, thank you.
Council Razak.
Good evening, how are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. And what is holding, you said you've had potential businesses that have wanted to come in there. What is it that you feel is, why haven't we gotten anything in there yet?
Well, you know, simply it's that to lease a space like that takes time and money. And so the individuals that are coming to look at the space have to invest time and money and do their diligence. So it's just a matter of time. You'll remember that we actually opened the Enterprise building about a year ago. So, you know, it's still relatively new. And so we're actively marketing on CoStar, which is a search engine, and LoopNet. So we're, you know, we're out there in the community, and we have in-house staff that also manage this along with myself to make sure that we get a tenant. And I'm in Brockton very regularly, so, you know, we're actively seeking this out.
The question, maybe I didn't phrase the question correctly. Is there something that's coming up when you're meeting with these potential clients? Is there a reason why you don't feel, is there something that on their end why they wouldn't take, are you looking more at chains, larger types of restaurants, or are you looking for something that's more, you know, small mom and pop type of
restaurant? Yeah, we would like that type of use, smaller mom and pop. Okay. So it's taking a little more time to find those
to be able to invest.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ranieri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Matthew. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Thank you. Talking about the parking garage, is that what I'm seeing in front of me, right?
Yes, that's the parking garage. I'm going to hold it up so the other counselors can see
it. Yeah, if I can. Yeah, no, I'd just like to see a little bit closer if I. Okay. So that's going to be located pretty much to the offset of where the parking lot is right now, almost where that, I call it, where we got like an L shape, right? So that's going to fill in that cavity pretty much?
So the 184 spaces that currently exist will go away and be replaced with the housing you could see on the corner of Montello and Petronelli Way. Okay. And then the garage will be kind of mid-block on Petronelli Way.
Okay, and that's gonna be for a total of how many spaces did you say?
474 spaces.
474 spaces, okay. Now let me just ask you, because I think everybody's been waiting for phase two. Some councils weren't here for phase one. Majority of us were, so. You know, the talk always was with phase two was the parking garage and, you know, other pieces of it as well. And I guess my concern is financing in place for the garage? I mean, do you have the financing to do project two with the parking garage? I mean,
we're actively seeking financing for the garage and for phase two.
And for phase two?
Yes, we are going to finance them simultaneously.
Okay, because I know under phase one, as we all know, $4 million of actual city money went to the project to really kickstart it, and there was a lot of conversation at that point in time when we did put the when phase one was being built and that $4 million was going to be placed, you know, to the project. There was a great concern by councilors then, and just, you know, using the $4 million, we did want to see something done there. It was a situation where we had a desolate corner naturally that needed to be taken care of. And I was one of the councilors that had a great big question mark with the $4 million, you know, for placing that, you know, into the project where I could have used the $4 million in other places. But be it as it may, it still did a nice job for what it had to do for what we have now. I just don't want to have any surprise or somebody coming back and or going through to the mayor and saying, well, in order for you to get phase two in the parking garage, you may have to. Saddle up the city may have to saddle up and put some monies into it, and I don't think that that's never going to work. You know what I'm saying?
Well, we're actively seeking financing for the garage.
Okay.
You know, the first phase did require public financing.
Right.
The second phase will require public financing. And there's going to need to be a continued reinvestment of public resources into downtown Brockton until the economics work from a market rate standpoint for a standalone project. And we are not quite there yet in Brockton. So we are working hard to make that happen. So, you know, that's kind of where we stand today. And I can give you more updates on the financing when those things come to fruition.
You're going to have to, because I don't think we want to be left with any type of surprises, because, as you know, we're not in this is the way I look at it. I'm just one individual, one counselor. But it's going to be awful tough for me to digest if someone stands in front of me and says, no, you know, now in order to do project two, you're going to have, the city is going to have to come up with $4 to $6 million. That's going to be an awful, awful tough thing for me to do. It really will be, with the situation that we have here in our city. You know, we're not sitting on a gravy train, and I think you know that. You've been working in the city long enough to see what we're trying to do, and the mayor has great ideas to what he wants to do, you know, with this whole renewal plan, which is what it is, a plan. But, you know, for me to jump start and see project two, I'm going to have a lot of difficulty with, you know, a big chunk of money going there when, believe me, we could be using it in other areas, in road construction and all that type of stuff. So I'm just, you know, keep us in tune to where we are financially. And hopefully, you know, it's not kept a secret, even when, you know, discussions are being made with the mayor, that it comes back so that the county council is kept up to speed on it as well.
Yep.
You know, I mean, I want to see the project done, but I'll have difficulty digesting to put public funds there again. That's my only thing, but. Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Monahan.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
Thank you.
Obviously, the parking garage is going to be vital to the future development of downtown Brockton. When you do this new phase two, is there a plan to get that garage built first, or then before the other 111 apartments there, or what? Because I think that's probably a pretty important.
Yes, sir. Yeah, Councilor, thank you for that question. We will look to complete the parking garage first. We will start the project as one project. So phase two will start and the parking garage will start. It takes anywhere from 9 to 12 months to build a parking garage. The housing takes a little bit longer, can take, you know, 18 to 24 months. So it will be complete first, and it's really essential to kind of help us manage the parking issues that we have. You know, we are going to be removing that 184 space lot, so having that garage built as quickly as possible is in the best interest of both Trinity Financial and the city, to make sure that we have adequate parking.
Okay, thank you. I mean, is the reason, one of the reasons, of as far as getting a restaurant in there, has it been the parking, that we haven't had enough parking down there? Is that something that will hopefully help?
I think so. I think that will benefit. You know, I can't say for sure, but I think, you know, okay, that will definitely add value as a prospective tenant is looking at that space and asking questions. Where do my customers park in the most immediate way so they can come in, have dinner, and then, you know, you go back to wherever they've come from, or stay within the downtown? You know, walkability is something we're trying to promote here. This is a transit-oriented development, so.
At this point now, the parking spaces you have, are they basically taken up by the tenants?
So we are utilizing our 1-to-1 parking ratio for the residential building. Okay. Yes.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Sorry, I just had a couple of questions. The question, but Councilor Monahan just asked, now the city, don't we use part of the parking lot? That's, and I found that out one day. So how is that, how does that work?
Sure. I can speak to the public resources that were put into phase one and the benefits that came to the city. There are many. You know, the Center Street rehabilitation is a benefit to the city. The Korean Vietnam Memorial Park rehabilitation and
it
expansion.
It looks beautiful, by the way.
Thank you. Great. Yes, we're very proud of that park, and we hope that it's adding value to the city. And then the 184 space lot is actually a lease to the Brockton Parking Authority for 99 years. We've turned the maintenance and operations over to the Parking Authority, which they've been doing a great job with. And in return for that, you know, we have to park our residential cars in that lot. So, but also, it's also providing an additional 150-plus spaces for the city to use and replace the parking that was originally there. So there is a benefit to the city in that having that lot there.
So will those spaces stay for the city with phase two, or
so it's actually an even better scenario for the city in phase two, where we own the land that currently is the parking lot, and part of the thought is that when we build the parking garage, what will happen is we will give that land to the city as well as the structure that's built. So the city will own, operate, and manage that parking facility. So it will become the second parking facility within the downtown and be owned by the city, and they will you know, get all revenue from that.
Okay. And last question, you mentioned something about what turning the street back to two-way traffic. Now, is that, have you, I'm sure that's just part of the planning, but on your list, are you planning to go before the Traffic Commission just to see how that would work and if that would approve?
Yeah, we've done a traffic analysis for the planning board, which we're actually presenting tomorrow night at the planning board.
The planning board.
So that document has been submitted to the city, and it looks at, you know, the new street and the benefit of two-way Petronelli. So that is available, and of course, we would work with the city to make sure that, you know, that's done with city standards. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Barnes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. How are you?
Good, how are you?
Good. Thank you for, you know, taking the time to meet with me a few weeks ago. But Councilor Aneri actually mentioned something that I don't think we spoke about. So, because I wasn't here when the phase one and the public funds that had to be infused into the phase one project. So that was $4 million. So what is the estimate of public funds that needs to go to this part two?
Yeah, we're still working through that, you know, putting the financing plan together. So, you know, as I get more information as it relates to that, I'll bring it before the council.
Okay. And I can't remember if we spoke about this particularly, but what's a ballpark grand total of this whole project, phase two?
I'm not sure what you mean, because there's a lot of different resources that come into a project such as this. So,
well, just the whole cost of getting it done. So from
phase two
to
is estimated to be approximately $61 million.
$61 million,
including the parking garage and all street improvements.
Okay, and was the $4 million that the city gave last time, was it a percentage of the funding that the phase one received, or how was that calculated that it came to four?
Phase one was about a $60 million project. So in the grand scheme of things, it's not a whole lot of money. We brought a lot of private resources to the table when we built phase one. So we'll be doing that again for phase two.
So I guess I'm just kind of asking, though, how did it come out that $4 million was needed to start the project or to get it going?
Just a point of information, because you weren't here.
Yeah.
That $4 million, I believe, was a grant from DHCD mm-hmm. to the city for this project. It wasn't $4 million out of our operating budget. It was a grant specifically for this project that was actually a pull-through, came through the city to the project, but it was only for this project from DHCD.
Actually,
okay, so
MassWorks, Mr. Chairman.
MassWorks, I'm sorry.
Okay, so it wasn't from the budget.
It was not from our budget.
No. I see.
There were no city funds in phase one, but for the contribution of, well, not contribution, there was a purchase of a parking lot the city owned, and that went through a 30B process, and there was dollars paid for that lot.
Okay. All right, I see. All right, thank you for clarifying that, and thank
you,
Mr. Chairman. Okay.
Councilor Sullivan.
Good evening, sir. How are you?
Good evening. How are you?
Good, thank you. I just had two quick questions. Relative to Petronelli Way, and I tried to look at it, the old order of the temperance movement. It's a historic building. We're actually Marvin Hagler, the Petronelli brothers.
Yes, sir.
Is that part of this?
It is
not. It's the one next. So on that display right there, it would be the building to the left, your building to the right of it?
Yeah.
These are our buildings.
Yep.
Here.
And what's right above that?
That is the...
Right, to the right next door to that.
This is city-owned land. That's land owned by others.
Okay, okay.
Part of this project.
Okay.
Any rights to that land whatsoever. It's contemplated in the downtown action strategy as developable lots.
Okay.
You know, future development potential for the downtown, but that is not part of the project.
All right. And my last question was, I thought I heard you say that when the ultimate construction is finalized on the parking, that it will, they'll be conveyed to the city of Brockton, so the city will own it and they'll receive the revenue. But how can you do that with your funding? How are you allowed to do that? How are you allowed to borrow money from an institutional lender, a private or a consortium, and then convey it to a municipality?
Yep. So the tax implications of a lot of this stuff are very unique, so we work with our accountants to make sure that that can happen. You know, it is, the garage is part of the entitlement process. So in that, there's a mechanism to utilize resources to build that garage and then convey it to the, back to the city.
But those resources, is that funding from, say, the state? Do you get, are you getting tax credits?
We're not using tax credits.
You're not using tax credits. So say you're borrowing money from B of A, Bank of America, to build this.
Yeah.
How do you then convey that to a third party vis-a-vis the city of Brockton? I can't follow that.
It's not, there isn't debt associated
with that. There's no debt associated with that at all.
Currently. So we're still working through that. The financing is still out there, you know, and so when I have more details on that, I will come before you and present that.
But based upon what you said tonight, the 11 of us can walk away knowing that the city of Brockton will be the ultimate owner of that parking garage?
Yes, sir.
It will be, huh?
Yes, sir.
All right. Thank you.
You're
thank
welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Anybody else? Can't do that. Thank you, Mrs. Zeller. Entertain a motion.
Recommend favorably to the full city council.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you.
Yep.
And councilors and Mrs. Zeller, sorry for the little banging and all, but we wanted to let the next group set up because they have a PowerPoint presentation.
Thank you all for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Item number 26.
Resolve to invite the Parking Authority Director Robert Malley, along with representatives from Nelson Nygaard, to present the findings and conclusions of the extensive parking study done for downtown Brockton. Invited Robert Malley, Executive Director of Parking Authority, representative from Nelson Nygaard.
Thank you. Thank you for waiting. They look like young people. They could stay up late, so we can take them out of order. Mr. Malley.
As you know, we've been going through this. It's just about a year now we've been working on the parking study, a lot, data gathering, et cetera. I want to make a couple of points. This has all been done in cooperation with the planning office so that it aligns with the downtown rehabilitation plan, a revitalization plan. And I would like to introduce the people who will present this because they're much better speakers than I am. Liza Cohen and Tom Yardley from Nelson Nygaard. This is the Cadillac of parking study companies, right? And I'm sure they will enjoy the presentation.
Councilors, can you all see, if you can't see the screen, if you want to move over a little bit? Councilor Beauregard, you may need to probably take one of the big chairs. Thank you, if you could start.
Thanks, Council President, and thank you all, councillors. It's 9 o'clock, so we have maybe a 10, 15-minute presentation tops. I don't want to stay here too long.
That.
Yeah, we might go quicker. Thanks, Bob. Nelson Nygaard, thank you for that nice introduction. Really about us, it's not really just parking for us. We're kind of at the intersection of design, architecture, planning, and what makes a downtown really tick. And so we look at it more broadly. Every time someone parks and gets out of a car, they become a pedestrian, they experience the downtown. So we try to look at the whole system comprehensively. And Liza's going to talk a little bit more comprehensively about specifically what our study involved. So got a lot of parking experience. This is some of the specifically parking related projects. We've done a lot of others in across the nation, but we're going to talk tonight a little bit about the parking study, brief you, give an update. It's a heavily data-driven study that we were really charged with looking at what is the existing supply downtown, the full inventory, making sure we do parking counts and get data-driven solutions and look more broadly at strategies. So we're going to present those briefly, and I'm going to hand directly over to Liza, who's been working on this.
Thanks, Tom. Hi, everyone. Let's talk about parking at 9 p.m. on a Monday. So.
Why did we do a parking study? I guess I need to stay close to this, right? So parking, as Tom mentioned, is not just about parking. It's about economic vitality. It's about your downtown. It's about every time you get out of a car being excited to be where you are and not being annoyed about the system that got you there. So we know that Brockton is seeing new development. As we just heard, Station Lofts went up, WB Mason is expanding, and there are a lot of exciting studies, including the Downtown Action Strategy and the Redevelopment Plan. So where are we? We kicked off this project, as Bob said, about a year ago with a series of extensive meetings with stakeholders. We went out and we counted all the spaces, we counted all the cars in all the spaces, we talked with members of the public and targeted stakeholders to kind of get the story behind the story of all of these data points, and now we're here before you with a set of draft strategies that we're pretty excited about. So here's our study area, kind of centered on, this is City Hall, and all the way out to Plymouth Street over here, Warren Avenue. This is Main Street running down the middle, just to orient you all. So overall, when we went out and counted, you might be surprised to hear that we found almost 6,000 spaces in your downtown, which may not be what you think of when you're hunting for a parking space downtown. On street, there were about 13 different kinds of regulations. So those are the signs, you know, when you pull up, they say you can park here, but not on a Tuesday and not at 5 p.m. and not if you're wearing green. And then a myriad of other spaces off street, but we categorize them into some basic categories, which essentially break down to, can I park here if I'm a regular member of the public? So 2/3 of those spaces are privately owned or restricted in some way today. So parking for Joe only, my customers only, this bank only, et cetera. This is what all of that inventory looks like mapped, and I apologize that this the writing is kind of small, but again, to orient you, here's City Hall. This pink block with the black outline is the Adams Garage. So as I said, we went out and we counted all the spaces, and then we counted all the cars in all the spaces. And this is a heat map showing where demand is high in that dark red color along a spectrum all the way down to where demand is less than 30% in those light blue colors. So we tend to say that parking is efficiently utilized at about 90% and below. So anything above 90% pretty much feels full because there's only 1 in 10 spaces available. You really have to hunt and peck. So looking at this map, as you know, you might expect to see, spaces around WB Mason are quite full. Spaces down by the courthouse are quite full. But then there are pockets of availability, Vincente's Supermarket, of course, over on the other side of the tracks, as well as, you know, right on street in between these heavily utilized off-street assets, which is interesting to us. We talk to a lot of folks about parking. We don't just want to look at numbers, because what really matters is your lived experience when you arrive in your car and you can't find a space or you don't have exact change or whatever it is. So we heard from all different kinds of people with all different kinds of needs across the city. I should add that all of these things I'm going through rapid fire. Bob has 5 very detailed, very thrilling technical memos about all of this. We did an online survey where we talked to about 300 members of the public, customers, employees, folks who own businesses downtown, all different kinds of folks. So what did we find? I'll rocket through these quickly. We found that there are perceived and there are real parking shortages. So as I said before, there are some lots, like the Lincoln lot that's right across the street, that when you show up at peak hour, which is about 10 a.m., and you try to park, you can't find a space to save your life. But right around the corner, there are lots that have a lot of availability, and those are shown in that light blue color again. So this chart on the bottom of this map right here is actually mapping availability at different hours of the day. So the map is only showing, it's really hard for me not to walk over there and point at things, but the map is showing 10 a.m., and the chart is, there are different times of day on the bottom on the x-axis, and then utilization on the y-axis. So what this is telling you is that at peak,
the light, the beige color is all the empty spaces.
Right.
At times of day. So it's 8, 10 a.m., 12 p.m., 2 p.m., 4 p.m., 6 p.m.
Right. So at peak, there are over 2,500 spaces that are going unused. That doesn't mean that today they're open to the public. They might be some of those Joe-only spaces, but there are 2,500 unused spaces at peak demand. We also noted that on-street regulations don't necessarily match up really well with today's demand patterns. So for example, along Main Street and over by the courthouse, your on-street parking is about two-thirds utilized. Up by WB Mason, that parking is about a fifth utilized and the rest of it remains empty. We know, as you all probably know, that you have some outdated payment technology. You have to scramble for quarters. The kiosk doesn't take anything under or over $20. You can't use a credit card, and you certainly can't pay with a cell phone, although you can do that in the back garage, which is interesting. We also heard from folks, including those administering this program, that the permit program is challenging. You've got something like 21 different facilities. Each person gets a permit to just their specific facility per month. Do the math. That's a lot of analog processing. Overall, we also found that the price is relatively low, so some people may just buy a permit so they can park 5 days a week. In general, in Brockton, you guys have a lot of people driving to your downtown. But if you look at the downtown, it's actually quite walkable. You have short city blocks. It's easy to get from A to B. You actually have a very great transit system. So these two charts are showing the current, what we call mode share, so how people choose to get to work, which we find translates pretty well to all trips. And in general, your parking regulations mean that your downtown is not quite open for business. The only places that you can park for more than 2 hours today are the Adams Garage and the Lincoln Lot, which, as we said earlier, is often full. Your Main Street is time-limited parking, which essentially says you gotta get out after an hour. So if you're coming to do anything for longer than an hour, like eat at a restaurant, you can't park in the downtown. Pretty challenging. Information overall, which is part of what people often find challenging about downtown parking systems, is not super available and it's not always consistent. You have those lovely blue signs, which are the parking blue, but they're a little bit small font, hard to read. This example, I think, is probably just a factor of the ages. You have reserved parking sign right next to metered parking, which I found confusing and just opted not to park there at all. In general, this is directly out of our survey, and it lines up really well to the action strategy survey findings as well. Survey respondents said their number one concern about parking in Brockton is safety and security. So lighting, sidewalk environments, interpret that how you will. We interpreted that just from walking around, that some of your walking infrastructure is limiting and perhaps leads folks to choose to drive rather than walk. And in general, the zoning code doesn't quite support compact development. I know that seems to be a topic that's up for discussion, so I won't delve too much into it, but again, very detailed, exciting memo on zoning. And overall, the governance of parking and mobility in Brockton is scattered. It comes from all over the place. The Traffic Commission looks over some parts of it. The Brockton Parking Authority supervises some parts of it. Some of it's the police, some of it's DPW. And that's really hard to pull all together when you want to make sweeping changes. So those were all of our findings. And we came up with a bunch of strategies to address some of these issues, which I'll also run through. Sorry for talking really fast. Overall, restructuring your rates so that the rates match the demand. So this slide is showing off-street permits. You have some areas that are in higher demand than others. And today, with your kind of lower prices for monthly permit parking, some of those permits are oversold, which leads to frustration, and then some of these lots are underutilized. So we propose three zones with a kind of premium zone at that Lincoln lot, and then zone 1, 2, and 3 with a tiered pricing scheme to match. Similarly, again, this is really hard to see, but matching price to demand on street and eliminating those time limits and instead allowing people to pay for as much time as they want, providing some lower cost spaces that are maybe less valuable and higher cost spaces that are more valuable right out front. So this is an example of how that might look. What's interesting about this is that you have some permit spaces that are on street today, and there are some very underutilized on-street spaces that could temporarily or for long-term be used for permit parking with that precedent. So this is just an example of what that might look like up by WB Mason. In general, we think you can use technology to your advantage. A lot of times, it's not the actual 25 cents an hour that annoys people. It's the having the quarter that annoys people, not to mention all the people that have to make change for the person who doesn't have the quarter. So using technology, a really easy one is pay by cell. That doesn't require any new infrastructure except stickers. And then smart meters, where the heads just kind of drop into the existing casing that's already there. Kiosks that allow people to use whatever they have on their person to pay to park. We think that you can take a slightly different approach to permit parking and switch to a more zonal system so that instead of being assigned to my one lot that has 14 spaces in it, I'm assigned to 6 lots that offer me 500 different parking options. And if I show up and my lot's full, I can just move over to the next lot. That will simplify things on the back end, but also hopefully make things more understandable to folks using the permit system. This is a really rough map, but we think that a lot of your streets are quite wide and can accommodate parking, which has the added bonus of some traffic calming effects as your streets get narrower and folks really feel like they're coming into a downtown. We counted up to 450 additional on-street spaces, just a rough count, but something to think about. So this is an example looking at Montello, where if you added, you could fit in 2 7-foot parking lanes on either side instead of 2 rather wide travel lanes and 1 parking lane on one side. The Brockton Parking Authority can pursue a shared parking and lease program. There are a million different permutations of this, either a public to private partnership or the BPA brokering a partnership between 2 private organizations. Regardless, we've given Bob a whole bunch of sample agreements from other Massachusetts communities to hopefully make that process a bit easier. But that's about leveraging some of these large facilities that go underutilized, particularly at the busiest time of day, which today is 10 a.m., but may change as you guys develop more of an active nightlife, et cetera. Looking at enforcement as being about more than just parking. So these folks are actually a great asset to a community. They are eyes on the street, boots on the ground, and how might life be different if they were walking around with a map with locations of cheap and free parking, if they were able to give directions. This is an example, I think, from North Carolina, where they kind of turned their parking enforcement officers into downtown ambassadors. One other thing that other communities have done, which I think is kind of cool along these lines, is on the back of their parking ticket printed a map of their parking system so that the next time you know where to go. So overall, kind of talking about broadening the mission of the Brockton Parking Authority, it's not just about stamping those permits every month, but instead looking at things like managing parking for availability to make sure that there are spaces right out front when folks need them and that there are lower cost options farther away from the front door. Restriping existing facilities to make them more efficient. We actually had a great meeting with the Traffic Commission so that we're able to work with them on signage and some different regulations. And then, as I said earlier, looking at some shared parking agreements. One other thing that we're doing is all of the data that you've seen so far is set up in a geo database, so now it's very easy to go out and kind of monitor how parking changes as your downtown changes. I think overall providing some consistent and clear information in the downtown, this one seems kind of straightforward, but we took a look at the signage, which often goes up ad hoc, oh, we need a sign here, a sign there, creating a consistent scheme with colors that match across the downtown. As well as gateway signage. So for example, if today you're coming into City Hall, and this is the garage down here, which as we said earlier is one of 2 places where you can park for more than 2 hours, you drive in, you turn right to go to City Hall, and or you come up from the south and you turn left, and you can't get down to the garage. So instead, thinking about placing signs a little bit earlier to intercept people on their trip and direct them to where they need to go. I love these signs that I believe the Business Association has put out that are pedestrian level, pedestrian level signs that help people understand where they are walking instead of just in cars, which helps keep people on the street. There are other multimodal improvements such as lighting and sidewalk improvements that actually help to unlock parking assets that today feel really far away. And in general, using the zoning code to support what you all want to do with your downtown. So we look at this with a parking lens. One particular thing that jumps out at me is thinking about your parking requirements and how much land use they're actually requiring, as well as curb cut regulations, TDM, which stands for Transportation Demand Management, which can be built into construction requirements, and adopting garage development standards that require things like active uses on the outside of garages so you don't wind up with a dead block. So those were all of our strategies in about, I don't know how many minutes, quick.
Not bad.
Our next steps are we're hoping to put together a public meeting to kind of run this by the public and let them know what the authority's thinking. Then we'll finalize our report and plop it online so everyone can have a little weekend reading. And that's it. So happy to answer questions or, any of
Council
us.
Councilor Beauregard, you file us?
Yes.
You have any questions or do you want to yield the floor?
Thank you. I will yield the floor in a moment. This is a demonstration of using funding and getting results. I was so thoroughly impressed. It's the third time I've seen this presentation. I've seen it evolve, but this is a demonstration of realizing what we have downtown, the assets, and turning them around and, again, finding a revenue source that exists and that we can expand on. So I want to thank you, and I want to thank Bob for, mobilizing this in the first place.
Thank you.
I defer to my colleagues.
Councilor Barnes.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for that presentation. It's interesting to kind of see it all mapped out. It's different when you're in the street and you can't find something. So it actually opened my eyes to a lot of things. So my thing was kind of, and I brought it to Bob a few times about the Park Boston app and how they have that. And I know that you have that on there, kind of upgrading the meters. So when you said something about using your cell phone, is that what you're kind of talking about, like creating an app, like the city would have to have like a Park Brockton app or something like that?
So there are a lot that are straight out of the box, so you wouldn't have to develop your own. There are vendors that offer that service. And
okay.
We created a implementation plan to go with all of these strategies, and that's one of the first steps is to kind of talk with different vendors and see what they have to offer. What's cool about some of those is that cities are starting to incorporate everything into those apps. So I think it's New Haven, Connecticut has also wrapped in their transit, so you can pay for parking and for transit all with one app. That's light years beyond Boston, but it's still pretty cool.
Okay. All right, great. Thank you. This is really good. This is really good information. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for the presentation. Very interesting. Quick question. You mentioned that you are going to put it online for everybody to be able to view. Do you know approximately how long that would take to be able to get this?
That's a great question. I think we want to go through any public meeting that we might do before we finalize everything. But I refer it to you. It sort of depends on that timeline.
So would you... This question's for Bob. So you have to have a public meeting beforehand to present it, or?
Well, I don't think we have to, but I think we want to.
You want to?
But
okay.
I was going to suggest that perhaps Councilor Beauregard might want to have a board meeting to present this as a public meeting.
Okay.
So Ward 2, Ward 5 together.
Oh. I don't know if I can do a
board meeting. Sure you can.
Yeah,
I mean, that way,
that.
Those are the two wards that are affected by the study area. Mm-hmm. Right, and then we would invite the stakeholders who originally had input into this to those meetings so that they can see what we came up with and kill, all those.
When did you want to do it? I'm planning a ward meeting in a couple of weeks, so is that too soon?
That would be great.
I don't think it's too soon.
No, that's great.
Yeah, we can
Council Beauregard?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right.
Let me know, Tom, and I'll get it out to all the stakeholders that we originally invited at the beginning.
All right, I'll talk to you Friday.
Great.
Okay.
Where? Councilor Razak, you?
That's it. Thank you. So I know a lot of people would probably want to look at it, take their time to really look. There was a lot of interesting things in there, and it's a different way to look at parking. I mean, it's pretty interesting. So thank you.
Great. All set. Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Bob, can I just ask you a quick question? With a lot of things in our city, and I hate to be the bearer of bad news, we see a lot of studies, projects, that before we know it become other projects and become require other studies and so on and so forth. When will we see some of the recommendations that are being presented to us so that, I mean, I understand, because I'm part of the Traffic Commission, and I saw this presentation in traffic, but there's some things in there that doesn't have to wait, you know, 6 years, 12 years, you know, for my grandkid to replace me here or whatever the deal is.
We've already started on some of this stuff, right? Streamlining the permit system. The outreach to the traffic, you were there, we outreach to traffic to try and change some of the parking regulations in the downtown, et cetera, right? As soon as we get buy-in, we're going to start working on all of it. I can see everything in the study being done within a couple of years.
Well, what about, like, for instance, the parking meters, you know, something that could be, you know, revenue generating.
Absolutely.
To a point where we're not taking advantage of what we could.
Parking is a resource that we've just been giving away. It's a city resource. We should be judging.
So when do you see some of those things being implemented?
As soon as the study's done.
You've already started.
I've done some of the research. Yeah, I've talked to vendors already.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what you say within?
It won't be long.
I might be able to see it in my lifetime.
Without tying myself to a specific date, because there are circumstances that I may not be able to anticipate at this point.
Okay.
But we're getting towards winter now. I would say in the spring, right, we should be ready to start with some of that stuff.
I mean, some of it, like adding to on-street supply.
If you can step up to the microphone for the people at home.
Some of it, like adding on-street supply, is, you know, necessarily low-hanging fruit, and it's the sort of thing you want to do first before more expensive solutions. And that really, you know, like Bob is saying, is before whenever the moratorium is in the city for putting down thermoplastic, you know, it could be before November 15th. But that sort of stuff could yield a lot of spaces where you need them on the street. People tend to want to park in on-street spaces before they go into a garage. So those are the sorts of things that, you know, we're helping hopefully look at, and I think Bob could move on working with DPW or whomever.
We do have a rough timeline that I wouldn't mind sharing with you,
okay,
as far as when everything gets done,
right,
that these guys put together, which is...
Actually, I was going to ask you too, Mr. Melly. Can you send me a copy of the PowerPoint, and I'll get it out to everybody, because it's pretty small for us to look at that.
Absolutely.
Way. So if you email it to me, I'll get it out to everybody.
Sure.
All the council, so they can see that.
Thank you.
There is a rough timeline at the back of that, so you could refer to that. It tells you, and I mean the entire, the last things are like 2-3 years out, right? But the, you know, within a year, you'll see most of this.
Yeah, because I think it's important for for the residents to actually see some. You know, we channel these studies, and then these studies sit in a corner somewhere collecting dust, and then before you know it, they become obsolete. Mm-hmm. And then we incommend a new study, and then that becomes obsolete because it seems that the way things
totally
have been
agree.
Done.
Totally
so
agree.
It's nice to hear that at least we can say, look, 99% wasn't done, but at least 1% was done, because and it was done within a particular timeline,
right,
which is great.
Okay.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr.
Thank
Chairman.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Razak, anybody else that hasn't spoken? Councilor Razak.
Quick question for Bob. Yes. What did the study at? Is there a final number of what it cost, what the cost was?
Yeah, the contract that we signed was for $95,000. We just tonight got $50,000 back from, so the cost to us was $45,000.
So when you say you got, who did it come back from?
From the state.
Yeah. So it came back as part of this, okay. And so the total, you gave me the number.
The total was 95, right?
Yes,
so we paid.
From the city is
the parking authority. No, from the parking authority.
Parking authority's
right,
budget,
45,
correct.
45, yeah.
45, okay, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? I want to thank Officer Healy for helping to set up the display. And if you can forward that, we'll also get it on the city website.
Absolutely.
A copy of this, so the public, because the public couldn't see that tonight, I'm sure. I'd entertain a motion.
Motion to approve favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council.
Thank
all
you, Councilor Beauregard, for bringing
all
us in.
All opposed, recommended favorably. Thank you very much.
Thank you again. Great.
Item 27.
Resolved that the city's mayor and solicitor come before the finance committee to provide a status update and to discuss reacquiring the rail property located at 226 Main Street commonly known as the Ganley Building, that was conveyed by the city for nominal consideration to the Commonwealth for purposes of using the property as a college collaborative, invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John A. Condon, Chief Financial Officer, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
If I could, just to inform my colleagues, myself and the president got some information from the city solicitor that they are working with the state on this matter. And to my colleague, Councilor Beauregard, rest assured that we will not let this fall apart. So I am going to, at the request of the city solicitor, postpone this until the second FinCom in November, at which time he'll come in and we'll have a valid status update.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the second meeting in November. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended second meeting. Item number 28.
Nightmares. Resolve that the chairman of the Board of Assessors report to the City Council on the process and steps followed as in assessing the value of homes in the city. Invited John O'Donnell, Chairman, Board of Assessors.
Councilors, I received an email earlier today.
Yes,
Councilor, Mr. O'Donnell is out of state for a family funeral.
Yeah.
I'd entertain a motion to.
Motion postpone. Next finance.
Second.
Yes.
Who filed this? Was this yours?
Yes.
You okay with that next meeting?
Yes.
Motion made and seconded to postpone until the next finance meeting. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended for postpone until the next meeting. Item 29.
Resolve that the mayor, police chief, fire chief, city solicitor, board of health director, and other relative city employees appear before the finance committee to discuss the recent actions taken by the city to vacate Tent City on privately owned property. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Philip Nazarella, city solicitor, John Crowley, police chief, Michael Williams, fire chief, Louis Italia Jr., board of health director, James Casseri, superintendent of buildings, Lawrence Riley, DPW commissioner.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Sullivan.
Point of information to the council, I did confirm with Larry Riley, DPW commissioner, that the city of Brockton was indeed paid on 9/14 by CSX, a full amount, which was $35,107. With that being said, I am going to make a motion to postpone this also to the second FinCom, and I will ask that the clerk only invite the first two invited guests, Mr. Carpenter and Mr. Nazarella.
Second. Uh-huh. Okay. Motion made and seconded to postpone until the second finance meeting in November?
Yes.
Second November. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommended postponed. And okay. Madam Clerk, if you make notation just to invite Mayor Carpenter and City Solicitor Nazarella. Item number 30.
Resolved to have members of the staff of the Brockton 21st Century Corp along with Mayor Carpenter inform the City Council on current projects taking place to promote further economic development, new business, maintaining business, and other outstanding issues being faced by this organization. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Rob May, Director of Planning, Robert Jenkins, Executive Director, Brockton Redevelopment Authority, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director, Brockton 21st Century Corp, John Marion, Chairperson, Brockton 21st Century Corp, Matthew Osborne, Treasurer, Brockton 21st Century Corp, Chris Cooney, President, Metro South Chamber of Commerce, Susan Joss, Brockton Neighborhood Health Center, Sheila Sullivan Jardim, Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, and Reynald Lado, Brockton Area Transit.
Councilors, I did receive a communication from Rob May. He is due to illness. I am unable to attend the finance meeting of October 3rd, 2016. Yeah. Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, I filed this, and I guess what we're looking for, Mike, is an update because I know there's been some changes with the board of the 21st Century Corp and want to see anything else is going on with new businesses because I have been speaking with some of the former members and current members about working, I guess, opposite of focusing on downtown, but working with the perimeters of getting businesses east, north, south, and west. So when people are driving in to the city, they, how would I say, it's more aesthetically pleasing, and of course, the revenue will be there for the city.
Yes. Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Gallerani.
Thank you, Mr. President, councilors. We do, you know, our B21's mission is the complete city. It's not just downtown. We are part of the partnership, the TDI partnership, along with the city, Trinity. The new member is W.B. Mason, and ourselves are the partners involved in the downtown. So we have we're very involved in the whole process with everything with regard to downtown. The Main Streets program that was established last year comes out of our office. Gary Leonard is the Campello Main Streets manager, and he is part of planning and development now, although he's housed in my office. So it's an interesting combination of things, but that's how we figured it all should work. I am part of the planning and development team that meets regularly, at least every other week, if not more. So we're very in tune with everything that's going on, and they're in tune with everything that we're doing. I think a few months ago I was here and I heard you loud and clear about the stadium, and I can tell you that this has been the summer of the stadium. I've spent a great deal of my time on issues with regard to the stadium and the Shaw Center, and that's continuing. And there's a lot we still have left to do, and you'll be hearing more about that in the coming weeks, months. And hopefully we will have a product, that being the stadium and the Shaw Center, that we will look at as an asset. Some of us have always kind of felt it was an albatross that B-21 was burdened with, and I've now taken the opinion that this is a great thing. And I think one time when I was here with you, someone said about having a waterfront as a, for some cities, that's a great asset. And I think my response was, but we have a stadium. And I finally have put my head around and my arms around the fact that we can take that stadium and that Shaw Center and make it key pieces of how we create an economy that's a destination economy for the city. New development, there's some good things going on. DW Clark is moving full speed ahead with their project with the LeBaron Foundry, and Dan Evans Machine is moving forward with plans, and he's before the boards looking for his permits to expand on site after we've been working with him for about a year on trying to figure out where he could put a satellite facility or how he could squeeze more into the space that he had.
That's what he's doing.
And I think it was Rob May that came up with, by looking at the layout of the land on North Manchester and determining that yes, in fact,
yeah,
he could squeeze more square footage out of that building, which is a great thing because he has a major contract, which means more jobs and more wealth coming into the city. You have specific questions? I don't want to wander. I don't want to, you know,
no,
it's
no,
late in the
evening. No, what we wanted to focus on, because one of the things that's been frustrating many of in the community is the, how would I say it, the lack of communication. So we don't know when you have your meetings and when you're going to have the next one. And also, I know there's been changes to the board. I know that Ray Ledoux had resigned and because of other, how would I say, commitments. And I believe a couple of other people have resigned, so now we know there's openings on the board, and we also wanted to be kept up, you know, and informed on that.
Sure. The board, by charter, is required to meet each quarter. So, because it's been difficult getting a quorum during the day, during business hours, because everybody has businesses or jobs that they need to be at, the decision's been made to go to quarterly meetings to see how that works. The executive board meets very regularly, and most things can be decided at that level and then taken to the full board on the quarterly meeting or, as we're having this week, a special meeting. With regard to the board changes, by charter, we're required to have a minimum of 12 members. We're well beyond that right now, so we're okay. And again, because of the need to have a board that's manageable in terms of quorum, 12 is probably the best number to get it. If it gets down to that, then we're good. Looking at potential candidates, if we do dip below that, that we can recruit to join us, obviously that's always in play. The two other members besides Mr. Ledoux that resigned, Matt Osborne from Eastern Bank, because he has a lot of bank matters on his plate and he needed to devote that all his attention to that. And Joe Casey, who was one of the VPs of Harbor One. And as you know, Harbor One went public and he was the person, the point person on that process. so he needed to devote his attention to his bank. So sad to lose the talent that we had with those three individuals, but all three of them are very important to their organizations and needed to be very focused on what they were doing. Communication, you know, we have open book.
So you're having a meeting this week?
This week we're meeting with Chris English from EMC with regard to issues at the stadium.
Okay. So
as council president, I'm a member of the board, and I had been complaining because I wasn't getting any communications. I did have a talk with IT and with Mr. Marion. I have been getting emails. They have been blocked as spam until today, actually.
And now okay. I have your personal email now.
Mr. Marion has forwarded me the emails that he was able to show me have been being sent for months, but I was not, they were blocked. IT is taking care of that, but I had given, not to be the Secretary of State, but I had given my personal email to please send them there for the time being so that I make sure I get them. I will be at the special meeting later. That's Wednesday, I believe.
Wednesday,
correct?
Yes, noon.
Okay. I will be there, and so we do have representation. There was a problem, and again, they were sending emails. I was not receiving them. So,
okay, thank you.
Just to let you know that's happening now, and I'll be able to keep you updated on items.
Okay.
And any other councilors, if you want to be put on the list to know when things are going on, just send me an email so I make sure I have your correct address. Because again, I find that a lot of the city addresses, for some reason, we get bounced out. I keep getting returns like the auditor's office this week. I sent a memo to correct our roster, and I can't get it through, so I'm going to hand deliver the list. It happens. It's just the way the system is.
Thank you. I'll defer to my colleagues. Thank you.
Councilor Farwell.
Yes, just a couple of quick questions, and you may not be able to answer these, and if you can't, just not a problem, just let me know. Do you know if the state has given their final approval to the urban renewal plan for downtown?
I'm not aware. I don't know.
Okay.
I can answer that for you.
Have we started expending any funds towards repairs at the stadium or conference center? I know the mayor, as part of his appropriation,
yes,
provided some funding, and could you just quickly?
Yeah, we were very fortunate this summer. I was able to have a student from Mass Maritime Academy available to us as a work co-op. For a few thousand dollars, I was able to bring in a facilities management, soon-to-be expert.
Yeah.
And I was able to get it was eight young men from the Youth Works program to work at the stadium on doing improvements to the grounds. Anybody that's been there in the last couple of years realizes it's just trash and weeds and looking rather suspect. That's been corrected. They spent the summer pulling weeds, picking up trash. We spent some money fixing the landscaping because some of the trees were dead. Some of them were just not very pretty. So made an effort to fix that. We mulched everything so it gives that finished appearance versus just dirt. We fixed a situation under the stairs at Gate C where the drainage it wasn't working because it was never finished. And that goes back to the original construction. There was trash under there, which was attracting rats and possum and other critters. So the young men cleaned that out, leveled it, graded it out nicely. We brought in crushed stone, so the water has a nice runoff capability. Hopefully that resolves that problem once and for all. The hope was to be able to get in and start doing some internal cleaning and painting and making it, give it a new face, which just, as Vince Lombardi says, we didn't lose, we just ran out of time.
How about some of those
critical
big items repairs?
We still have a claim in with our insurance company with regard to some of the issues with the Shaw Center, tracing them back to the winter storm of 2 years ago. We have 3 years to be able to make the claim. That's in process. The insurance adjuster believes that we're going to get some finding in our favor. So until that happens, we will keep chipping away. The issues that we have that we'll be discussing on Wednesday with our tenant is kind of a piece of what we have to deal with in terms of some of these other repairs is very much on my mind. How we're going to, what the strategy is to make it the best it can be. I'm committed to that personally, as well as B21. We know what we've got to do. It's just we also have to understand that we're talking about nearly $1 million that has to be invested. So it doesn't come easily. Our budget this year, as you know, was cut back. So I'm trying to leverage that the best that we can. My goal this summer was to make it a good experience for the consumers by making the place feel and look better. And I think we made strides in accomplishing that. And we're going to continue that path as well as those high-ticket item corrections that have to be made. Absolutely. But some of them go back to the day when it was built. So we'll just keep working at it. And we're committed. I can tell you that. The day doesn't go by that some discussion about Stadium Shaw Center doesn't come up.
All right, my last question, and again, you may not be able to answer this, but the urban renewal plan as adopted, it did identify certain current city-owned properties.
Yes.
With some suggestions of how they could be developed. Do you know if we have started sending out information to potential land use developers for example, Quincy underwent an urban renewal plan. Maybe some of the developers are interested in coming here. Do you know if we started actively marketing the plan as proposed and as submitted?
It's been kind of a soft marketing, bringing developers in and showing them property, mm-hmm. And getting their feel for it. See, our feel for whether they're interested and would they respond when an RFP goes out for the properties. Talking up all these properties and the potentials, again, it's something we do regularly. We all, the team, that being myself, Rob May, and Robert Jenkins are the three, and all the people that work with us. So we're always looking at what the potentials are for any of these properties that the city owns as well as other properties that need some repurposing in the city. But yeah, it's right there, constant. And the building the concept of having a commercial kitchen co-op space with a commercial kitchen and the restaurant incubator, that consultant has been brought on and they are moving forward. So there is this progress. It cannot happen as fast as we all would like it to, just because the enormity of it all. But we're moving forward.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Razak, finish.
Thank you, and this is a really quick question. There was a great event, was it a few weeks ago over at the stadium?
17th of September.
Yes, right. Country Fest. Now, give us, I know you were a little, wondering how did it end up turning out?
It did fine. I don't think it was the home run that we would have hoped for, but it did well. I think it was 5,000 or 6,000 tickets sold, which is good.
Very good. I think that's great. I mean,
yeah,
I know
it's 13 for a concert, so the goal would be to hit those double digits. But it did good. It did well.
But I think it created a lot of. There was a lot of information on social media. There was a lot of a nice buzz in the city. A lot of people that wanted to go.
Yeah.
So I was hoping you'd say it was. Success, and we do more of that.
It was, and hopefully we will, because it's a great way to show the city to people that otherwise maybe not come to the city. Because as you know, the city of Brockton has a perception issue that we're always combating, and the stadium and the Shaw Center, as well as a couple of other facilities in the city, are a way for us to invite people in that otherwise wouldn't come. So anytime we can do something like that at the stadium, we're looking to do it, and that's part of what the strategy is going to be going forward.
No, and I mean, I have a lot of friends that attended, and it was really an overall positive event, so
good. I'm glad you had a good time. That was good.
Thank you.
I guess we didn't get away with it. No, Councilor Rodriguez.
Just a quickie one. Well, first of all, I want to thank you for being here tonight, and I know Mr. Jenkins was here as well, too. At least they took the time to come, and I'm going to perhaps leave this comment as an advice to us to perhaps stop inviting these other folks on the agenda, because it seems to me that this is the third time we've had all these folks in the agenda, and as far as the president is concerned, he didn't hear from anybody, so other than Mr. Mays, so perhaps we ought to just maybe keep him off the schedule. But I just wanted to ask you a quick question in terms of the baseball schedule. Is that done ahead of events, or is it done in conjunction to certain other events? Because I'm actually thinking of a couple of things that we might be able to do next summer, but if the baseball schedule kind of trumps scheduling at the stadium, it might be hard for us to do some things.
I can't give you a definitive answer. I do not believe the baseball schedule has been developed yet.
So if we were able to schedule something at the stadium, then there's a possibility that they would work around the schedule?
Yeah, okay. Or at least if you're thinking about an event, pick two or three choices, and then let's see how it can all fit together. Because remember, we have the high school that takes 50 days of the schedule. Got a couple of colleges, and obviously the Rocks. So. But they're all done. I mean, the Rocks are done at the beginning of August, so still plenty of summer left on that end. It's the front end of the summer that can get a little bit dicey in terms of picking a day that absolute, because there's so many different teams that are relying on those fields.
Yeah, because we were actually looking to the festival that we do here in the city. We were looking to move it to the stadium, but there was a conflict.
Send me the dates and let me work on it.
That's the reason I'm asking.
And figure and see if we can lock it in for you. If you can.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you very much for coming and sticking around until this time where others couldn't take the time to do that. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Just to point on those other people are all volunteer members of our board, and I think after the third.
But they should still notify you if they couldn't
come.
But
tonight, I'm assuming we're going to put this to bed anyway, so.
Yes, well.
Anybody? Oh, sorry. Hold on, Councilor Sullivan.
Scalarani, how are you?
Great.
I don't have any questions for you, but I have a request. A few months ago, I requested on behalf of the council, I wanted a copy of the note and the mortgage and the deed from way back when the city.
Was Jay getting that, or was Mr.
Conlon was there as well. I don't know who was going to get it, but there was a representation made that we would get it. So I would like it PDF to the president.
Sure.
And he can give it to all of us, because I've.
Yeah, I believe Mr. Conlon was the one who said.
I mean, it's been months. It's been months.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think it might have been. Each of us thought the other.
Perhaps, but if we could get that, that'd be great.
I'll make a note to get in touch with Mr. Conlon tomorrow.
Thank you.
It was the deed and.
It was the note, the deed, and the mortgage.
You take the.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Okay.
Councilor Beauregard.
Yes, I'm going to recommend that we move this favorably, but the idea is to continue this dialogue and be informed of what's transpiring.
Second.
Thank you.
Your motion is to recommend favorably.
Yes.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably.
Can I ask a favor?
Thank you. And
can I ask a favor before you let me out the door?
Quickly.
Every night, every time I've come, I'm always the last on the agenda. Could you move me up next time? Thank you.
All those in favor? Opposed? Yes. Recommended favorably to full city council. Councilors, before any moments of personal privilege?
Yes.
Councilor Razak.
I'd like to remind everybody that we're having a Ward 7 community meeting this Thursday, October 6th at 7 p.m. at the Raymond Elementary School on Oak Street. And I would also like to remind everybody that this Saturday, October 8th, is Tower Fest at DW Fields Park from 11 a.m. to 4 p.m. So I hope everybody comes out and joins us at DW at Tower Fest. There's lots of activities, lots of fun things for families and kids to do. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Barnes.
Yes, I just wanted to publicly thank all of the residents that attended the at-large councilor meeting a few weeks ago on the 5th. It was well attended. I think the information that was shared was much appreciated. We had a lot of great questions, a lot of good dialogue. We opened up a new relationship with the state agency that I think is going to benefit the city going forward. And I want to thank my at-large colleagues, Councilor Rodriguez, Sullivan, and Farrell for allowing me to kind of guide that meeting. And thank you very much for allowing me to serve. And thank you folks for being attentive and also watching on TV. It's very important that you be informed.
of what's going on in the city. So thank you for participating and partnering with us.
Thank you. Before we adjourn, I just want to say that over the last about 4 to 5 years, Ms. Chuckren's illness and being out full-time and then out part-time, and now we have a new city auditor about to be sworn in, but Anne Marie Raymond has done yeoman work for the last 4 to 5 years. Thank you for it. We're adjourned.
Thank you, Anne.